Hello and welcome to the Computer Game Show. My name's David Turn. I'm here with James Farley.
Hello.
Sean Bell.
Hello.
And Matt Murray.
What is happening?
Whoa, he ruined it. He ruined it. We nearly went for the tripler and he ruined it. I'm not sure when you're going to be able to listen to this. You know, these usually come out Wednesday, but it's Valentine's Day tomorrow. And to be honest with you, it's not worth risking my life to put this podcast on the internet. So I'll try and get it edited, but it might be a day late. Sorry about that. Yeah, it's been an interesting... It's been one of those weeks. Sometimes I get to Monday and I think, I can't believe we're recording another podcast tonight. This has gone way too quick. This week, it feels fucking ages since our last show. What was the follow-up like? Does anyone... Matt, did you pick anything up?
Yeah, a few things. Matthew Duffy tweeted in to say, lots of adults play on a 2DS. This is after you thought it would be hilarious.
I saw
Dave.
That. It was funny.
You know, the thought of me playing a 2DS on a train. But Matthew Duffy says, lots of adults play a 2DS. Much more comfortable to hold and can't see the 3D anyway. I guess this is just Matthew's point of view.
No, you missed out the best bit. You missed out the best bit,
plenty
which completely ruined everything.
Oh, that must be true then. It must be true.
Plenty of people, men on Rollmark, are using the 2DS. I'll leave off. They're not adults. They're kids in like grown up bodies. We all know that.
See, the thing is, right, is I question it as well, because it's not more comfortable to hold. Like, and it doesn't matter with the 3D or not, because with the 3DS you can like tilt it to whatever angle you want, and the screen is much sharper. The screen on the 2DS is terrible.
Did you see that video that was doing rounds on Twitter yesterday about the new 3DS and how the screens on those things are the most inconsistent things of all time? I was amazed, right? Because basically there was a video of someone that's obsessed with getting the ultimate new 3DS, and she's ended up buying, what was it, 6 or 7 of them?
Seven, yeah.
To try and get this, because there's two different types of screens they use. One is just insanely worse than the other one. And sometimes you get one with both bad screens, sometimes you get one with the top one is a good screen, the bottom one's a bad screen.
What's worse about it? It's
nowhere near as sharp, nowhere near as bright. The viewing angles are just insane. Like, she just showed it by panning a camera around to the left-hand side a bit, and it was like, whoa, like, I literally can't see one of the screens. The other screen you could see crystal clear.
Oh, my God.
She
was saying, like, even if you do get the higher quality screen in these things, and it seems completely random whether you get them or not, if you do end up with one of the higher quality screens, sometimes the colour balance is, like, completely different to the other ones as well. Like, she's got one with two really good screens in it, but the one of them's, like, a little bit of a yellow tint, the other one's a little bit of a blue tint. It just, like... And it's become her obsession to try and get, like, the perfect one. So what she's done is... There's, a common problem on the new 3DS where, fluff gets underneath the screen, like the bit of plastic that goes over the main bit of the screen. And so she sent it off to Nintendo to get it cleaned out, and she sent it with instructions saying, look, just put two good screens in it. And now I can't wait for her to, like, she could do a video when the new console comes back. I can't wait to see what she ends up with.
That is amazing.
I remember this was the thing on, I don't know if it was the original DS or the DS Lite.
The DS Fat had the problem with the pixels. Is that what you mean?
That's right. There was dead pixels. But then there was also, they just started doing ones where, like, if it was the only one you'd ever seen, you wouldn't even notice. But if you compared it to an older one, it was like, oh, shit, the screen on mine is yellow.
Yeah, I remember that, yeah.
It just seemed to be potluck. Like,
yeah. It's amazing, really, because it's never entered my head. In terms of build quality of their consoles, Nintendo, for me, have always been the best. You know, I've never had a problem with a Nintendo console at all. And the quality always seems really good. I mean, we've always spoken about, you know, the DS Lite and how you can boot it up 3 years after it going nowhere near electricity and it's still, like, got half battery and all that sort of stuff. And, the only time I've seen poor build quality actually was on the DS Lite when, do you remember the hinges would crack?
Yeah.
You wouldn't notice it at all. And then someone, like, there was a post saying, take a look at your DS. Has your hinge got a crack in it? And I'll open it up and go, oh yeah, fucking has as well. Like, that's really weird.
My ones, the 3DS I've got is because I've got the new 3DS, like the small one, and that's got like a bunch of weird problems because, I mean, the battery on it, I mean, when did it come out, the new 3DS? How many years ago?
It will be, I only know because it came out around the time of Monster Hunter 4, so it's about 2 years.
Yeah,
because 2 years. Yeah.
The battery of mine is wrecked now. Like, as in,
really,
like,
mine's okay.
It hardly lasts like a day. Like, if you know, in standby,
hardly
like,
lasts a day. Okay. You know, the Switch has got a 3-hour battery life.
No, in standby, like it hardly lasts a day in standby, and it's like, or I mean, today it was fully charged this morning. Now it's on red, and I haven't even used it. It's that's not so good.
It's all those street pass hits. So you walking in and out of schools,
can't handle it.
Trying to avoid the police, but you know, to try and get a few street pass hits.
The other thing about it is, you know, because you know, you can like change the plates on it as well. Like, so you can have like different designs, but I've always found that it feels like they're going to come off. Like, I've just got the ones that come with it, but they just feel really loose. Like, they could just sort of come off all the time.
You see, I ordered
make a tappy sound.
I ordered a Monster Hunter thing to go with it. So that basically, I changed that on day one, and I think I binned the originals.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Okay. Well, that was an interesting side chat. Anything else, Matt?
Faceplates, just like Nokia's.
do you remember Sam Wiley? You had a Nokia 3210.
Mate, I had one with that where you pressed a button and it covered the numbers on the 3210, and you pressed a button and it slid down. It's just completely pointless.
Amazing. What, isn't that a Matrix phone? Function.
Yeah, it was made to look like the Matrix phone, but it was also covered in footballs because I liked football as well.
So, you had a football version of the Matrix phone.
I had a football Matrix phone.
Jesus.
Yeah. The coolest kid in school.
Yeah, you watch in school, giant leather Mac, footballs all over it.
Do you remember those kids? You'd always get one. I mean, we all like the Matrix, but there'd always be one that turned up at school with one of those long leather jackets on and like black sunglasses, and you'd be like, mate, come on.
Yeah. you still see him now. Like, what? You're not going to find Morpheus.
The second two films were shit. Give it up.
I think there was quite a few of people like that at the Switch event we went to. It was,
Was there? A few of them. Yeah.
No, there was just all loads of people wearing backpacks. That always wears me out a little bit.
What's wrong with
growing
backpack?
Up wearing like a proper like rucksack thing. Mm. No, like, you know, when it was two, when you double strap it and that, it just don't, not for me.
I just sort of feel like, how much stuff have you got to carry around, really?
3 years.
Like a messenger bag, fine. But I mean, I travelled down from, you know, the northwest for the day, and I didn't need a bag. I was all right.
Yeah, messenger bags.
It's full of women's phone numbers, this bag. I don't believe in that, mate.
Messenger bags look better, but it's just easier to have a rucksack.
A messenger bag?
That's, you know, like a satchel.
Yeah, that's what you... I mean, you get away with that. There was a time where you couldn't get away with it. We've all moved on. You can get away with it. You can't get away with, like, a backpack thing. I'm sorry, Matt.
Well, so you can. I've got a laptop in it. It's just easier than having it over my shoulders.
The only adults that walk around with those things are the ones on nudist beaches. When they get there, they put them on and they're butt naked walking around with these rucksacks
on. That's what I'm doing on the way to work. Just backpack, laptop, dick out, you know.
When we went to that Switch event, that bag I had is brilliant. It's a baby bag. As in, you know, those ones that you have that you keep.
And I'm getting jipped for a backpack.
No, it's one of those ones that you...
Who's pointing at you, Matt? Do you wear a backpack then?
Yeah, well, I said I wear backpacks. I got like a laptop on the way, you know, take it to and from work.
No, like obviously, if you actually need one, then that's absolutely fine.
No,
thank you, Sean.
No. I'm just saying it's just people who wear them casually that bother me.
Oh yeah, yeah, no, yeah, don't yeah. There's literally no need for that. Casually on the weekend, I have a tote bag. James, what were you saying? Like a baby bag?
Well, no, because the one I've got's from Mothercare because it's from when
we used to.
No, it doesn't really look like it. But the best thing about it is it's got tons of pockets, you know, because of all the like the wet wipes and stuff. But also, it's got this really handy bit where you can put a drink in and it keeps it cold.
I think I've got the same one. I've got the one in black.
That's the one. Yeah. It's
black.
Brilliant.
It's got the little fridge compartment and it smells of baby sick.
It's just about the right size to put a laptop in. It's amazing. And you've got like, you know,
I
cold drink.
I wouldn't put any of my laptops in it because it's full of like crumbs and like snotty tissues. And that's before I even got involved.
Saying that, speaking about backpacks, and I'll admit, do you remember my old laptop backpack that I had, Matt?
Yeah, that was huge.
Yeah, it's someone, you know, when the bloke, you know, when we got burgled and my laptop got stolen, he saw that in the corner and just thought, well, perfect. This makes stealing this man's equipment even easier. I'm stealing something to make it easier to steal from him. I was furious by the time I got home. Yeah.
But by that point, you've always seen a man walking down the street and you're like, loser, backpack.
For a moment then, I thought you were going, bub, right, okay, Matt, what's the next thing?
Speaking of shit banter, Kurt Lewin tweeted in, my weird phobia is the noise of rain at nighttime on the window. And this is referring to last week when we talked about what we're each scared of.
Really? See, that is weird, because I love that. That's like one of my favourite
things. I find that really relaxing.
Yeah.
Yeah, I love it. I love it.
And Kurt Lewin takes it one step further by saying, I drown out by putting a fan on, even if it's cold.
Shit.
What? I think that would do my head in if I'd suck a fan on. It's annoying in summer, like when you have to have it on because it's hot. And but yeah, I like the sound of like rain on the windows. It's nice. You feel cozy indoors, don't you?
Yeah.
Worst thing about those fans, and I don't know if what fan technology is like now, but the worst ones about those fans is when, you know, when they click. You know the ones with a little spinning, like, cylinder thing at the top of them, and they move left and right?
Yeah.
And you could click and you could push a cylinder down and then they stay straight.
Yeah, locked in place.
Do you know when they break a little bit and they're supposed to turn right, but they don't, and so they just click and, like, sort of shudder just a little bit?
Just
winds me up. Like, that makes me feel sick inside. This is that my office is full of those ones. It's just everything just clicking off all over the place. It's a fucking nightmare.
Everyone's using those Dyson ones these days. I haven't seen those clicky
things
for years.
The blade ones?
Yeah, you can't move them in my office.
What, the blade? Oh, yeah, because you work in a cunt's office, don't you? Let's face it. No one bought them, Matt, and that's why they've tried to turn them into hairdryers, which is also something that nobody's using. Dyson are fucked, mate. They make good hoovers, but they can't fucking invent anything else. They're a nightmare. Where did we go with this?
Sam Wiley tweeted in.
Hello, Sam.
Saying the computer game pod Game of the Year is now only £13 on PSN. I've just checked and it's still 13 quid. So Trackmania Turbo.
Oh, you've got to get it.
13 quid, get involved, everyone.
Get that, it's a good
get
game.
Get involved, you will not regret it.
Although it is disappointing that there's barely any 100 player servers up at the moment. In fact, actually, I think there's about 80 people playing it online at the moment, and it's a little bit disappointing, but it's hard to get.
I've knocked it down, I guess.
I guess. So get it and get on there because it's well good.
We had some other follow-up from a guy called Woo Ben. This may have actually also come from the Midnight Resistance Discord, but we'll take it anyway. Discussion of Emily Rogers' prediction of Switch sales numbers. Does she have any experience or knowledge in the consumer market? No one could predict something like this. Then Dave goes on to make several predictions on the consumer market. Dave?
Who's this person?
It doesn't matter. Woo Ben is his name.
Do we know this person, Sean? They're from the Midnight Resistance.
It's from the Midnight Resistance Discord. It's someone called Woo Ben. Beyond that, I don't know who they are.
Everyone knows Woo Ben.
Can I just say, Dave? Did people not understand what I was saying last week? Because that means absolutely nothing. Not at one point did I say she wasn't allowed to make a prediction. My
it
angle
sort of
was
sounded
not,
like that, though, a bit.
No, it didn't, if you actually listened to what I said.
I actually said that it's pointless making predictions. That's what you said.
You're talking over yourself, all right? Calm down. Well, I know you think you've got something here. You've got a bone. That's fine. Calm down.
I smell blood.
I never said she couldn't make a prediction. I said, why are we talking about her prediction? Of course she can make a prediction. I think they're going to make about this much amount of money. I think they're going to sell these. Why? Well, because of this, whatever. All of a sudden, we're sitting here discussing this person's prediction who has no ties to Nintendo whatsoever. Why were we discussing it? That was what I was saying.
Because she's a prominent Nintendo writer and blogger.
She leaks shit. She leaks that, well, Nintendo are doing this.
No,
Nintendo
she
doing
leak
that.
Stuff because
she's not
Nintendo.
Michael Pachter. She's not like, turning around. Michael Pachter.
Hang on.
Whoa, we're getting totally confused here. She's like a prominent Nintendo, you know, games critic, journalist, whatever you want to say. She's got, you know, a well-respected blog for Nintendo stuff. She had a say in her point of view on these things, and that's that. What's wrong with that?
No, there's nothing wrong with that. She can say that. That's totally fine.
Good.
But we
Emily,
were going,
you're forgiven.
James was going, so Nintendo are going to sell 16 million? No, that's what this person has said. But I don't think they are.
Hang on. You've just said it's perfectly all right for her to have like an opinion on this because of her background. Why am I then not allowed to have an opinion about her opinion?
Mate, anyone can have an opinion on it. Anyone can. Right, what would you do if we get to the news section of this show and I go, my dad reckons they're going to sell 4 million units. What do you guys think? Do you think my dad's right?
Any connections to Nintendo?
Exactly.
And we established that she did have, and then you still got upset because you didn't want to talk about it. And then,
that is not what happened. That's not what happened at all. You were elevating this opinion like as if Nintendo had outright come
out and it had been linked internally.
Yes, she did. Why the fuck were you even talking about it? Why didn't you turn around and say, here's what I predict? If you had turned around and said, here's what I predict, how many units they'll sell, right? I would have openly okay, why do you think that? Oh, really? Yeah, well, you know, that's how discussion goes. Instead, we had, this person thinks this. Right, okay. What are we going to do with that information?
No, that isn't what we had. We had, this person who's got ties, you know, some sort of ties to Nintendo thinks this. What do we think about that?
Yeah, and how much does she know about the consumer market? How much does she know about the consumer market? All we know is that she leaks little details about Nintendo's next machine Nintendo are up to. Right? Does she know much about the consumer market? Is she projecting sales from internal leaks, or is it just an opinion she said? And then, what are you getting angry? No, I just want to know why we're discussing this opinion. What's special about this opinion? Because this was an opinion that created quite a lot of discussion on Twitter. She did say that there would be a new Mario game, so her prediction's probably right. No, listen, James.
We were talking about whether it was right or not. We were talking about the fact that she had an opinion. And what's wrong with being able... This is ridiculous. I don't know why you're getting so angry about it.
Dave, did Emily Rogers dump you or something? Did she take you down from the school dance?
She's blocked you on Twitter, hasn't she? She didn't have the chance to dump me
because she didn't reply to my emails, Matthew. All I'm saying, right, there are a lot of opinions out there, James, right? We do a two-hour show a week. We can't discuss everyone's opinions at all times unless they have something... Is that what you want? That's basically what you're saying.
We're not allowed to discuss anything that anybody says unless it comes directly from a press release.
Hold on, whoa. We're allowed to discuss anything you want, James, but have I got to sit here and just be like happy about it?
Is that what you're saying?
I could cut that and say this is shit. I could say, I don't want to talk about this. Or is that not allowed? What sort of rules are we implying on this podcast?
You're the one who's laying down the rules by saying, like, what you said last week, you just kept on saying, why are we talking about this?
What's this about? I questioned why we were talking about it. I didn't say, we're not allowed to talk about this, I'm editing it out. You're going, you have to like what we're talking about, David.
I didn't say you had to like it, I just said I didn't see why you got so annoyed about it.
And my point is, anyone's allowed to have an opinion. Of course they can. Everyone's allowed to predict things. Of course they can. I never said they couldn't. What I'm saying is, why are we talking about it? And you had nothing.
That's not true at all. We absolutely had something to back it up. Think about it. We were just talking just then about like the background that she's got, the track record she's got about the things she said and everything.
This is a week later, mate.
That's what we were talking about last week.
What did you say last week?
Exactly the same thing.
Well, she's leaked things about the Nintendo. And I said, yeah, but what knowledge does she have the consumer market? And you went, she leaked stuff about Nintendo, David. We absolutely never said that. Go back and play the tapes. Go on, dig them out.
Can we get on to the most important thing that Wu Ben pointed out? Was a few minutes later after that, he just said, did Sean just say paper, scissors, stone? I did. I don't know what came over me. I apologise. I don't know why it wasn't rock, paper, scissors.
Oh, yeah. It's rock, paper, scissors, isn't it?
Paper, scissors, stone. So, yeah,
I do apologise.
I'm joking.
You can't let it go, can you?
You can't let it go because you got all excited. Oh, yeah, we've got him. and then you haven't.
Well,
and now
you're
like,
obviously, because, you know.
We did back it up by what we said this week. No, James. No, that's not how time works. That's not how time works.
You're an
idiot.
Anything
else, Matt?
Go on.
Yeah, the last major bit of follow-up, I guess, is we had another mix of last week's episode. Wasn't done by Capone.
Can we skip out this guy's Twitter feed?
Well, it's...
what's his Twitter thing?
It's... his name is Mark Murphy. I know that much. Yeah. His Twitter handle, if anyone wants to go find his stuff, is Shomputer Games. So it's S-H-O... What is it? S-H-O-M Pooter Games. Shomputer Games. Yeah. Mark Murphy's on the mix of last week's episode and probably with some bits of the episode before, but we've tweeted about it, so you should go and have a listen. It's on YouTube. I think we've probably retweeted the link to the video, but yeah, go and have a listen. Not everyone is a fan. Luke Boardman, up with Nail on Pie, says it's like Capone but without the subtleties. Hashtag Poundland Capone. And then Neil Harmon, Harmon on Twitter, that was far superior than the shit fest that Capone subjected us to last week.
Ooh, so I mean, that's good, isn't it?
Not a fan. It's amazing, oh, yeah. but it is on our Twitter feed, and I'll retweet
James,
it.
James, have you heard the final edit of his stuff yet?
I have, yeah.
Did you hear what he did to you?
I did, yeah. Who's one? Which one?
For those. When he changed your voice to say stuff that...
No, I've not heard that one, no. I heard the
brilliant.
The first
We're
going
to play this, right, okay. So, the YouTube channel you want to look for... So, basically, this Shomputer Game guy, right, is taking episodes of our podcast and editing them in a very Capone-style way, but as, you know, with cutting out all the chat and just making noise with our podcast. You can find them, Mark Murphy, on YouTube. I think you have to search. That's M-U-R-P-H-Y. And this is what he did to James. Hopefully it's at the right bit. One sec.
I'll tell you what, I got a really good, reasonably satisfying cock. Well, you see, I've played with my boner every night since Feudal Japan, like a longer time ago.
Yes.
But it still doesn't feel forced. Did I send you that picture, Dave? The one of me gyrating around in my pants? I'm a pretty much a sex addict. I don't really care because touching my boner, not in a weird way, it's good.
Well, then,
a lot of crap came out in my cock. Used underwear.
Not bad.
But it still doesn't feel forced. Did I send you that picture, Dave? The one of me gyrating around in my pants? I'm a pretty much a sex addict. I don't really care because touching my boner, not in a weird way, it's good.
Well, then,
a lot of crap came out in my cock. Used underwear. Not bad.
So thanks for that.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
I genuinely had to pause it in my office because I was laughing so hard. Like, I had tears coming out of my eyes.
Oh, amazing. So, anyway, I've just retweeted it. It'll be on our Twitter feed. But if you want to tweet us, it's at ComputerGamePod or thecomputergameshow@gmail.com. If you want to give us any feedback on this episode or any episode, or you want to make a mix, whatever, those are the ways to contact us.
Smooth. Sean. News.
News. Right, that first bit took ages, didn't it? I'll try and be quick. So there's going to be a Castlevania TV show on Netflix.
Is this live action or is it animated?
It's animated.
Well, they haven't said, but Adventure Time, the production company that do Adventure Time, called Frederator, are the ones doing it, which suggests it is going to be a cartoon.
Yeah, right, that's what I thought. Yeah.
But Warren Ellis is writing it. Like, he's written two seasons of it, apparently. So, brilliant. So, yeah, that could be amazing.
At least somebody's doing something with Castlevania, because Konami sure as hell don't care about it anymore.
I've never played a Castlevania game, but does that have quite a rich and storied history?
Oh, for goodness sake.
Yeah, but it's not told... Like, the dialogue's, like, mostly terrible. Often, you know, memorably and comedically so, but, yeah, they're not, like... engaging stories, really. What else? E3 this year. Normal people are allowed in if they pay fuckload of money.
$250 a ticket. Tickets are already on sale, so no doubt they've already sold out.
Yeah.
It's really that expensive.
Yeah.
It's only 15,000 members of the public, which is actually, like, I mean, that's nothing compared to, well, even compared to EGX,
EGX is way more, yeah.
Yeah. And I mean, apparently, like, obviously, we've never even tried to go. Apparently, it is a lot like EGX in that it's, you can just be like, here's a link to my blog. I'm a member of the press. Please let me in. Not that I'm slagging off EGX for that. We've definitely, you know, we've dined well on that attitude for a good few years. So much appreciated. But yeah, apparently E3 is much the same in that, like, you still have to pay to get in, but it, you know, proving that you were supposedly press was not difficult.
Do you get anything extra? Like, is it just tickets to enter? Is it that do you get stuff?
Well, it makes you wonder. Like, do you even get, like, do you just get in on the show floor? Like, because you'd still miss, like, the keynotes and stuff. You still have to watch them in your hotel room.
Apparently, surely it's tickets to the keynote speeches as well.
Because apparently there's going to be more events as well at it this time. But they're going to do some, like, panels and things like that they don't normally do.
I don't think, I mean, those E3. If I think back to last year's E3 shows, the Microsoft, that at least had loads of people like standing near the front. Those seemed like they were regular people rather than press.
No, they were Microsoft employees.
Usually paid to be there, aren't they?
I tell you what, the end is nigh, isn't it? This is their attempt to transition over to it being a consumer event.
It makes you wonder. Like obviously, this indicates that just being a supposedly inward-facing thing just doesn't work anymore. And obviously, you know, we've all said, like with all the conferences and stuff, they've not been aimed at the press for a long time. They've been aimed at, I mean, obviously, you know, a lot of E3 stuff ends up in mainstream press, which is huge, but everyone's watching the stuff at home. It's not, you know, like when there's a bad E3 presentation, people are like, oh yeah, but it's for the shareholders, isn't it? It's for the investors. Bollocks. It's been bollocks for years, because they know that millions and millions of people are watching them all over the world. Like, it's been consumer facing for ages.
If it was all business, we would not see them. Yeah. this is them transitioning over to, because it's not, you know, it's not a big press thing anymore. The press are going to report on it regardless.
Yeah.
And, you know, even the companies seem less and less interested in doing them.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it says on the Eurogamer piece that people like EA and Activision already have their own events anyway, away from the show floor, which means that's less revenue from them, and that's what E3 people are trying to recoup, I guess, falling revenues from people who would normally be there with huge booths.
Well, it always feels like no one really cares. It's like, it's because really it's like the first couple of days, isn't it, when they do the you know, they do those big keynotes, and then the rest of the stuff doesn't really matter that much, does it?
The rest of the world sort of stops paying attention after the.
I mean, we do care. I love it, but at the same time, it's not what people think it is. And as Sean says, it hasn't been like that for a while. I've just got a feeling that this year's E3, now that you can buy tickets, right? And it's James's turn to completely avoid E3. Someone's going to spot him in the crowd. One of the events.
Yeah, I mean, that's a way of getting around it.
With one of those fake noses and glasses on and that little moustache thing underneath and just, like, looking left and right.
The rules were that you couldn't go on the internet to check news, and that a way around it is for James just to pay the money and fly to LA. For those of you listening who are maybe a new listener, but I don't know what we're doing. Basically, last year's E3, Dave avoided all news for a couple of days, and then we recorded a show during E3, and then told him the news that had happened. Most of it real news, some of it fake news. And this year, it's James's turn to avoid any E3 news, and then we'll do the same to him. And it's me in 2019.
Are we doing this?
What do you mean, are we doing this?
Do we give a shit for people that don't know what we're talking about? I mean, are we just going to explain everything now? Is this how we're going forward, Matt?
Just when did you decide this? I'll explain it for some people who are late at the event.
Fuck them. You turn up late to the party, you don't know what's going on. Simple as that. Catch up is the answer there. They're all
Dave's
on the internet.
Like, look, I want 5 listeners and I don't want any more.
Exactly. Sean will be happy with that, because he hates when things get popular.
Yeah, exactly. Be good. What else? Right, James.
Yeah.
The Nintendo Switch is shipping without a web browser.
Or anything.
Or any media apps or anything.
Yeah.
How do we feel about this?
We see, I think this is a terrible idea. Like, I really, really think it's a terrible idea. I mean, the web browser, maybe not quite so much, but particularly, like, the no media apps thing. And I know that there's the whole argument of, like, oh, we've all got these on every device ever around us. But the thing is this is like a portable device, and they were talking about this on The Verge, and they were talking about the fact that, you know, when you go away somewhere or you take something with you, you take, like, your phone, maybe you take, like, you know, your laptop, or you'll take something else with you. This means if you've got, like, a device like the Switch, which plays all that stuff as well, it means you don't have to carry so much stuff. You can just take this with you. It's it makes so much sense to have that stuff, and also to sell it to other people as well. Like, people that are more casual people are more likely to be interested if it has that kind of functionality as well. You know, it's like, you buy this, it does all these things, and also it plays games. It's like, I don't understand.
James, can I ask you a question? If this had an internet browser, Netflix, BBC iPlayer, and all that out of the box, would you ever use that stuff
yes,
on that?
Yes, because I've used...
Bollocks.
No, listen to
bollocks.
Me. No. Because I've used
fucking
the web
bollocks.
Browser... No, I've used the web browser on the Wii U quite a lot. Because...
Why?
No.
Why would you ever
do
that?
Because, fun fact, it's pretty good for watching illegal football streams. Because...
someone said to you.
Someone told me that, because you can bypass all the adverts, I heard. And so...
James, I'm not being funny, mate. If it had all that stuff on there, you would not use it.
Different, because this is a portable device. There's even more chance, you know. And James is absolutely right. I think it's a massive fuck up by not having a browser and iPlayer stuff.
I think it's a massive fuck up on paper, Matt, but you would never use it.
We're the kind of people that don't that have all that kind of stuff, but other people don't, David. Not everybody is like packing tons of devices like wherever they go. And it's like...
They don't need to. They do everything on their phone. Everyone does everything on their phone.
Everybody does that, David, yeah?
Well, like, who are you talking about? Who are these people that are going to be infuriated?
Put it this way, right?
I've
got, like, an iPhone, like, 6 Plus, right? And I would much rather use like, a tablet of the size of the Switch to, like, watch stuff on Netflix. I'd much rather do that if I had the choice. And that would be another selling point of, like, another reason why I'd want to buy it.
You'd buy it just... You would...
No,
that would
buy,
be the selling
that's
point.
That's the whole point.
That would
it's
be the
not,
selling
no,
point.
No. That's what you're not understanding here. It's not the sole selling point. It's a nice addition. It's something which is...
Yeah, no,
which can
it,
help
you're
you.
Absolutely right. It's a nice addition. It would be nice to have, but really, is it
this
going to
be
the thing that's...
But then why not have it? And the only reason they're not having it is because Nintendo are too cheap to pay the licensing costs or whatever for any of this stuff. That's the only reason.
Well,
I
know your other point that you made in on WhatsApp, James, was probably this is more of a security worry,
yes.
right? Because this is where a lot of vulnerabilities have been found in previous bits of Nintendo hardware.
Yeah, they go through the web browser. It's a
yeah. So I mean, I sort of get it, but yeah, I do feel I see what Dave's saying, and probably never use these things, but also. Part of you thinks, like, oh, just go on, just do it. Like, how much effort is it for all the money you've spent on R&D for the entire console and the interface and the, you know, the APIs and everything? Just fucking put a web browser and Netflix.
But they said
on
that
it.
It's never coming, or that it's
no,
not.
No, it just said it's not
at least
launch.
At launch.
But
yeah,
then they
yeah,
also
yeah.
said that whole, like, we're just focusing on the games, like, all three of them. You know, it's like, that's the whole thing. It's ridiculous.
Oh, that was cutting. James thought about that one, didn't he? He's written that on his
head. Came up with it a second ago, but yeah.
I guess my issue with this is, will I be able to get on, like, public Wi-Fi on the train with no browser?
No.
Since you mentioned that, when you first mentioned that, right, I was like, oh, that's fucking hilarious. Of course, you won't be able to. Pretty sure you will, because there are other devices that do that, right?
Well,
they come up with that weird little pop-up thing rather than a like it's like a notification rather than trying to load up the browser completely.
Well, this is what we were saying the other day, because I mean, like, Nintendo had some deal with the cloud, you know, the service called the cloud, you know, which David thought was hilarious that I said that they had the cloud.
If it's just the way you said it, maybe they could make a deal with the cloud.
I know, for some reason you didn't know that there was a company called the cloud that provides free Wi-Fi.
Of course I knew. It was the way you said it, you tit. Stop being so just all the time now you're like, oh, I'm really going to show David up here, and you don't, and you just embarrass yourself
because you just say ridiculous ridiculous things that don't make any sense at all. You're James, always trying James, to go James. For an angle to have a go.
James, guys, James, the, James, the take your voice down an octave, right?
The cloud.
Let me try and just make you look better on a podcast. Take the voice down a little bit, and then you sound less stressed. And then I've not won that way, have I? When you get all stressed and oh, but no, then I've won. I've won, James.
No, you haven't,
I mean?
David. You're a dickhead.
Right, so they're going to make a deal with the cloud.
Yeah, like they did with the DS. And so with that, you could get online, and there was no browser there either. And you could use it for, like, playing Mario Kart and stuff in McDonald's
or
whatever.
So how did you log in to the cloud on
I
DS
know.
And stuff?
I think it
just recognised that it was a 3DS, didn't it?
Yeah.
It just let you in.
Yeah, that's fine if you can access the cloud, but like if you're on, you know, like the main train from London to Edinburgh, that's you know, it's a virgin train. No, I'm talking
it's
about one of the biggest main lines of train in Britain. You have to like go on a browser to log into Virgin's Wi-Fi or whatever.
Yeah,
that stuff could be a bit annoying. But
get around that.
I don't,
because it would be weird if that's not in there, because obviously you're not going to have the ability to take it through like 3G or anything, so how the hell would you use it on the internet?
Yeah, I guess I could tether to my phone, but
but this is also Nintendo, and you know they're terrified of the internet as well, so maybe it won't have it at all.
Right, next thing. Have you fucking seen this new Humble Bundle?
I saw that today, yeah. It's amazing.
I literally just seen it, yeah.
So this is the Humble Freedom Bundle. Basically, 100% of the proceeds go to charity. Humble are also, well, they've also, say, they will also match the first $300,000. They smashed that a long time ago. That took about half an hour. So they're putting another $300,000 into charity. Charities are, where are they? ACLU, which is the American Civil Liberties Union, which could do with a few bob right now. Doctors Without Borders and the International Rescue Committee. Right, I'm just going to try and do this in one breath and see how we go. This is what is included in this Humble Bundle. Some of these are books, some are games, mostly games. Right, here we go. The Witness, Stardew Valley, Subnautica, Day of the Tentacle, Overgrowth, Nuclear Throne, Octodad Dadliest Catch, Invisible Ink, Super Meat Boy, World of Goo, Mushroom 11, No Time to Explain Remastered, The Stanley Parable, Super Brother Sword and Sorcery EP, Super Hexagon, VVVVVVV, Information Does Want to Be Free, Audiobook, I know, sorry, I couldn't help it, Walk Away Chapter 1 Preview Audiobook, R in a Nutshell, Second Edition, Guacamele, The Swapper, 30 Flights of Loving, Spirits, Human Resource Machine, Rockets, 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 The Boys Volume 1, A Little Gold Book of Ghastly Stuff, The Smart Girl's Guide to Privacy, Practical Tips for Staying Safe Online, Any Empire, 2064, Read Only Memories, Virus Named, fuck it, Virus Named Tom, Seven Grand Steps, What Ancients Begat, Mini Metro, Retro Game Crunch, Tower of Guns, Walking Mars, Waking Mars even, fuck it. Song of the Deep, Monster Loves You, AI Warfleet Command, Sproggy Wood, Hot Tin Roof, The Cat That Wore a Fedora, Secrets of Raticon, Girls Like Robots, Ellipsis, Streamline, Ninja Pizza Girl, and Robot Roller Derby Disco Dodgeball. And they might add more later.
So basically a load of old shit, really.
Man, there's loads of good stuff in there.
That sounds worth it for Stardew Valley alone, let alone all the
other
great stuff.
So definitely worth having. You've got The Witness, Stardew Valley. Subnautica is still early access, but I know people who really enjoyed it. Day of the Tentacle, if you've never played it, definitely
it's
worth
great,
a pop.
That
it's the remastered
version. Are you literally going through them all again?
No, it's just that they've put all the best ones at the start, haven't they?
Here's all the games, and now let's go through them again with a little opinion.
Nuclear Throne's great. Octodad.
It's all right.
I wasn't. Yeah,
I still
want to
play that.
People think it's really funny.
It's really.
I can't believe that's not been on PS.
Oh, there you go.
I can't believe that's still not been on PS Plus. It's weird, isn't it? That was like one of the first ones they were pushing at the launch of the PS4, and it just went quiet.
Yeah. Invisible Ink is apparently amazing. This was on PS Plus, and I tried to play it on the PS4, but all the text was tiny, so I would rather have the PC version. Stanley Parable's amazing.
The Swapper's really good.
Sword Sorcery. Yeah, The Swapper's really good. Melon's really good. It's just, unbelievable. $30 is the minimum buy-in, but that's
$30.
Fine.
Fuck that! I'm not made of money. next news.
Splatoon 2 is getting a demo in March, although don't really know how that's going to work, given that the online infrastructure apparently won't be in at that point. But
listen to Splatoon 2. It's from the 24th to 26th of March. So did Splatoon 1 do one? Is it did? Didn't it?
They
it
did.
Yeah,
they did
those.
Yeah.
It's the 1 hour, like 1 hour slots to get me, you know. On March 25th, it's 1 hour from 3 a.m., which is nice in Britain. On 26, it's 1 hour from 4 a.m.
You're kidding me.
Hang on. I mean, there's others, isn't there?
But basically, there's a few. So it's 7 p.m., so that's fine. 3 a.m., 11 a.m., I'm at work. 7 p.m., 4 a.m., 12 p.m. So, I mean,
Hopefully it'll work better than the Splatoon, like the original one did. Because did you remember that, Sean? Because there was all that thing where they had to keep extending it because the servers kept crashing. And they kept on saying, oh, yeah, we can get on tonight, and it didn't work.
Why don't they just do one of the normal beta things that you see everyone else do?
Why don't you say, look,
it's up for 2 days.
But isn't this better because... Okay, no, I don't know if this is better or worse. It sounds a bit shit, but the fact that they're doing one-hour slots means that they can suddenly test loads of people getting logging on at once, and that's what's going to...
I think that's the idea, is that it's proper stress testing rather than just being like, well, let's just leave it on over a weekend and it all sort of levels out, whereas...
There's other ways of doing that. Most of them do, okay, open beta like they usually do, you know, where you get it for a weekend or whatever, but they say if you log on between this time and this time, you get an exclusive skin or whatever. You know, there's other ways of doing that to force people to log on at the same time.
Like, if you do that and it doesn't work, that's just going to annoy people and make them think it doesn't work.
Basically, everyone's going to get on at 7 p.m. on the 24th, and if it doesn't work in the first 10 minutes, everyone's going to go, tights, yeah.
It's more of the fact that like you're asking everyone to show up like for a dinner party or something, and just like saying, sorry, the oven's broken, you'll have to go home now, maybe we'll do it next week.
It's broken now, come back at 3 a.m.
I'll definitely
be there for the 7 p.m. Friday one.
Of course you will. 11
a.m. the next morning. Well, yeah, exactly. Nothing else to do. Zelda be tucked in by then. I'm not doing the 3 a.m. and 4 a.m. ones, but I'll probably be around for the others.
Right. Okay. You should just play Splatoon 1.
Yes, fucking same thing.
You've got that. any more news?
That's it.
That's it. Okay, we can get on to what we've been playing then. We should probably start with Sean this week.
All right, okay. I played a game called Refunct, as in defunct, but refunct, which I guess means to fix a thing. This was, I can't even remember why I bought this. It was a Steam sale, it was 70p, looked all right, why not? It's such an odd little game. Like, it takes about half an hour, start to finish. And all it is it's like first person, and you're on like some cubes in the middle of like an ocean, and you jump around, and you notice that every cube you stand on changes color, like goes from being gray to green. And then you jump up these cubes, you get to the top, and there's like a special button that you stand on, and then more cubes appear like next to the ones you're currently standing on. And basically, the whole game is just making your way up and around these cubes, like colouring them in as you go, and then standing on a switch, and then more cubes appear, and then you clamber around those as well, and it just keeps going and going and going. And you just sort of build the whole game world as you go by hitting these switches, and then being like, right, and then sort of looking around, right, what's appeared now, and then trying to get there. And it's just good. It's like it's obviously been made with like no budget whatsoever. But like the controls just feel good. Like you can just, at no point do you get pissed off with them. There's no like confusion or frustration about how to reach places. You're just constantly like zipping around doing stuff. And like there's like a wall jump ability. And then once you figure that out, it's like you start looking at, there's like a really high point you've got to reach. And then, well, hang on a minute, there's like two posts that are like next to each other. So if I can line myself up, I can just go doot, 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 and like bounce between them and then get all the way up. And yeah, half an hour. I was just like, yeah, that was good. I enjoyed that. And then closed it and deleted it. And I never play it again. And I just had a nice time.
Yeah, I've just looked at this. This looks really nice.
Yeah. That is basically it. If it's going cheap, like, definitely have a go. I also finished.
What's it on, Sean?
This is on PC. I played it. I don't think it's on anything else.
Right. Okay. Fine. But,
yeah.
It looks perfect for VR. I know it's like a wanky Matt Murray thing to say, but it looks like it would be perfect. It looks very much like a game called, I think it's Tethered on PSVR, where you sort of jump between massive, huge, it looks very much similar to this, in fact. But Yeah, it looks class.
Yeah. Right, I finished Fire Emblem Awakening, and it is probably one of my favourite games of all time now. I talked about it previously, didn't I? I think me and James briefly discussed it. Oh, of course we talked about Tharja, didn't we? Yeah, of course we did. What a fucking tremendous game. And like you know when you finish a really good game and sort of you're ready for it to end, but then when it does, you have that sensation of like, well, what am I supposed to do now? Like, what am I... like, I don't even particularly want to play anything else. I just want to buy the next Fire Emblem game and play that. But I haven't got any money because I'm saving up for a Switch. Just unbelievably smart. There's no point going into detail because it's all about raising these characters and sort of getting, you know, like manipulating their classes and stuff to get specific abilities and getting units paired off with each other so that they A, have kids and B, like help each other out more in battle and stuff. And I just fucking loved it. It's the only game I can think of that paints like marriage and like having kids in like a positive way. And like, you know, so many
basically
games...
Basically lies to you.
Yeah, it's a work of fiction, yeah. Sean.
Well, you know, the kids are only good because you didn't have to actually raise them and they just appear like 20 years old because they've come from the future.
Yeah, just amazing.
Yeah.
But it's just, you know, like so many games, it's like if you've got like a kid or a wife, it's like, oh no, they're in danger, I've got to save them. It's never just like, oh yeah, that is just a positive thing that I have in my life. But like in Fire Emblem, because of the way you pair people off and the way that actually helps you in combat, you're always like if you're like doing a tough battle, the first thing you do is you make sure that like all the married couples are with each other because they fucking back each other up and they help each other. And that's nice. Mm. I like that. Like, it's not something you see often. And then ditto with the kids. It's like, again, because they build that relationship up and they're more likely to help each other out. So you make sure that like these little families all stick together on the battlefield. And I've never seen anything like that in a game before.
So how do the married couples help each other? So if you've got a couple of characters near each other that aren't married, nothing would happen. Whereas if it was a married couple, are they going to counter or what are they going to do exactly?
You get basically, yeah. So you like, if you have a unit and it's on its own and then in a standard combat encounter, you'll like, if you're attacking, you'll hit the enemy will hit you back and that's that. Sometimes characters have abilities, so they hit twice or whatever. But then, like, yeah, if there's another unit next to them on the battlefield, they will also appear in the encounter. And if they don't have, like, any sort of relationship whatsoever, it's very unlikely that the secondary character will do anything. Whereas the sort of the better their relationship is, they'll give you, like, stat buffs, and then there's a good chance that they will also attack alongside your character or they'll defend your character or whatever. So basically, yeah, if you, like, make sure that you've got all these like solid couples all grouped together, they basically just never get hit and just destroy everything. And it's wicked.
If you have a child next to a parent, does a child step in and do something, or is there only...
Yeah, absolutely. Like it there's like basically any two characters can develop some kind of relationship, but then there's like special, like the highest levels are reserved for characters who can get married and have kids. Yeah, and like when a child comes into the game from the future, they automatically get like the lowest level of support, whereas normally you start with nothing, where it gives you a bit of a head start with the kids. So then it's like, right, well, I'll work on that because it's easier. And it's just, yeah, it's just nice that like familial ties are actually sort of celebrated and actually proved to be a bonus rather than a hindrance.
Yeah, it's nice.
You know,
it's pretty awesome. Sean, towards the end, you get like, you can just sort of like romp through the ending, I think, from what I remember, because the characters
are... Yeah, basically,
are
like the final
so well.
Boss was my guy and his wife,
yeah.
Who were just fucking untouchable. And it's like, yeah, that's cool.
Well, see, the game has permadeath in it, right?
It does, but I turned it off because I'm a cunt.
Okay, no, that's fine. I don't think there's, you know, you don't have to play it that way, I assume. But what interests me is how do they deal with losing, like, a child in that situation? Because I don't think I'd be all right with that.
So they sort of cheat a bit in Awakening. I gather, I may be wrong, and I'm sure someone will tweet at us angrily if I am. In the older Fire Emblem games, it's like characters did, like, die and they would be like taken out of the story, and the story sort of rewrote itself a little bit, which is really cool. In Awakening, they just sort of go, oh, I'm wounded, I'm going to have to run away. And then they can't fight anymore, but they're still in the story. So no one actually dies.
Right, okay.
It's just a child. It's not a child dying, it's just a child bleeding out for 16 hours.
That's a good point.
Brilliant.
So no one's actually dead.
Is this the most recent
anymore, which to me just felt like a shitty sort of halfway house, which is why I didn't mind turning the permadeath off. A lot of people will tell you that is not the proper way to play a Fire Emblem game.
But a lot of people need to fucking get in line and shut their mouths, don't they, Sean?
Is this the most recent Fire Emblem game on 3DS?
No. This is, God, what, about 4 or 5 years old, James?
Yeah, I think it's about at least 3 years old. Yeah.
So since this, they did sort of the Fire Emblem Fates series, which I'm still trying to get my head around. So there's Fire Emblem Birthright.
Yeah.
And Fire Emblem Conquest, which are two separate games, but unless you buy it online, in which case you pick one and then the other one's paid DLC or something.
Yeah, and they like kind of then, link together. One's more focused on sort of like story stuff and one's more focused on combat, from what I remember.
The story's basically like there's these two kingdoms and one's nice and one's shitty.
Mm.
And you were born in the shitty one, but you were stolen by the nice people and raised by them.
Mm-hmm.
So if you play Birthright, that's your character choosing to stay with the nice people. If you play Conquest, that's you choosing to side with the shitty people. But you're fixing it from the inside,
yeah.
So it's all right.
But then
once you've done those, you can then play, it's just called Fates, isn't it, the last one, which is like a DLC chapter, which is basically where you go, do you know what, fuck the both of you, I'm off. is apparently like super hard, but it's the proper story, right?
Conquest is also supposed to be, I think, quite a bit harder as well than Birthright.
Yes.
It's like if you're going to play it, you play Birthright first because it's easier.
Yeah, but it's like, so if you buy it on the eShop, it's £40, and you pick Birthright or Conquest, and then you can play the other one. I don't know if you have to pay more money or I think you do. And that sort of functions as DLC. And then once you've done that, you can then buy and play Fates, which is really confusing.
It's weird that it's a Nintendo game in my head.
Why?
Yeah.
Why? Because it deals with stuff that Nintendo actively tries to avoid.
I don't know. It depends. Because, I mean, like the Earthbound series or Mother series is like a bit like, you know, does that kind of thing as well. It's just Nintendo, like, more recently have sort of scaled back doing anything like that. I mean, they don't do like Metroid stuff, I think, for similar kind of reasons, because it's like, yeah, the themes in that are a bit different to the standard stuff.
Yeah, but I'm talking about like the tits and the fucking and all that sort of stuff. It's like,
it's not like hardcore porn or whatever. It's just,
They're just like, the characters just get married and then a child appears.
But the characters you've shown me from that game, James, not far off
that was not
porn,
me,
are they?
For a start, that was Sean that posted those pictures to the WhatsApp
and
group.
You go, and,
to
yeah,
be fair, and to be fair, I think one of those was fan art. So I just really
yeah, James is fan art.
Ridiculous.
Yeah, but it is, like, it's strange. It is funny to, you know, see Nintendo deal with that sort of shit. It's just weird, like, I don't know. It seems
it's
very
nice
different
because it's
from
done in a way.
Stuff.
Like, obviously, it's all softened, so like, there's nothing inappropriate in the games. But yeah, I think like, in terms of themes and stuff, they do aim a bit higher than perhaps a lot of Nintendo stuff does. It's nice.
A lot of tits in it, though.
Yeah, there's a lot of tits in it. no avoiding that.
I mean, I'm not complaining. I'm just like surprised. That's all. They're like, I mean, they've been known as the sort of family friendly.
I mean, in terms of shying away from things, there's this heavy focus on relationship, but no same sex relationships, as far as I'm aware. That is something that people could understandably be upset about.
Well, they had that whole thing with Tomodachi Life as well, didn't they? With that.
Well, yes. Mm-hmm. It was a bug.
Yeah.
Gay people are a bug, apparently.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah. Well, that was basically what they said.
that's messed up. Right, okay, cool. Is that your list?
That's me, yep.
I'll do me quickly because it's very, it's not very exciting. I've been playing a game called How to Survive 2 on the PS4, which I believe is a PC game from last year, the sequel to How to Survive. believe it or not. It is a zombie survival game, and it does some good things and it does some bad things. It makes the survival mechanic, the survival mechanics is something in games that I've never really enjoyed. It's one of those things that I always think that I'm going to enjoy more than I actually do when I'm playing the game. Do you know what I mean? Oh, right. Okay. Yeah. I've got to keep eating and I've got to, you know, find food and water to, you know, keep myself alive and stuff. And then I play, Don't Starve. And I'm like, no, I'm literally just keeping a little bar up every now and then by pressing a button. The way this game does it is they've made it really, really simple. So it gets to a point where I have had those moments where I thought, oh, thank fuck, I've found some water and stuff like that. That's the good side of it. It just flashes up. When you don't see any bars or anything going down, you just, every now and then, you'll just see a little symbol on the top left-hand corner saying, look, you're thirsty, get this sorted. And it's not like, here's how long you've got before you're dead. It's just like, if you're thirsty, your aiming's not as good. If you're not strong enough to carry what's in your backpack with all the materials you've picked up, then you'll walk slower, which obviously in a zombie game is not a good thing to have happen. The problem with it, I mean, it looks okay. It's like an isometric look, and there's this weird sort of, so you're walking through forests, and because the camera, you can't move the camera, you'd think, oh, it's a bit annoying because there's loads of trees in the way. But what it does is there's a sort of weird bubble, like X-ray bubble around you, that so when you're walking through trees and stuff, you can always see your character. But it also means that you can't really see what's in behind the trees just in front of you, which is a good thing, because I've had a few moments where I'm like, oh, fuck, okay, right, let's go back, and stuff like that. I don't think I've explained that it's a zombie thing, but it's a zombie thing. There are zombies everywhere.
It's assumed, to be honest.
Yeah. Which, you know, there's not an original fault in the game when it's come to the enemies. This is the main problem I've got with How to Survive 2. The combat and the enemies are just, they might as well not be there. It's not fun to play in terms of combat. You're using like bats and stuff like that, and then you get a gun which opens up a few other things, but it's really easy to take out one. When you're surrounded by four, it's not that it becomes hard, it's that it just means that you can't, when you're battering one, you get hit from behind, and it's like, oh, okay. There's not a way of avoiding that. It's just that's what happens. I suppose the way to do it is to drag them out one by one, but it's just, because it's not actually fun taking these zombies out, it's kind of like, I might as well just wade in and see what happens. It's got big fat zombies, and you know what happens when big fat zombies are in these sort of games, Sean? They get too close, they'll explode.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, it's all that sort of stuff, and it's kind of like, if you're doing a zombie game in 2016, do something different with zombies, you know.
What about if they're doing one in 2017?
Well, this is a 2016 game, Matt, so take that smart comment.
I can bore you off on that.
take that smart comment and fuck off. You know when Left 4 Dead come out? That was, I mean, the market was saturated with zombie games. There was loads of zombie games. But what that did was introduce these new ideas and play around with the idea and try and get back. It was amazing, really, because it went back to the root of zombies as an idea. You know, like the whole shit, you're surrounded. And then, you know, like the amount of zombie films you see where the end is not this bright, colourful ending and yeah, we defeated the zombies, is actually in a completely fucked up environment where most of the people die, and it sort of took that idea and added new takes on zombies. So yeah, that's where you had the different, you know, special infected and all that sort of stuff, and it felt fresh even though it was using zombies, something that we've always had to shoot in computer games. This does none of that, and I'm not quite sure. I mean, it's competent. It works. I haven't hated it. But at the same time, I have no idea who's going to be playing this. You know, it's your usual fetch quest. You meet this guy at the start called Novak, and he tells you to go on missions. So you go do a mission. Or the missions are always kill 30 zombies or find bits to create a gun. You know, it's stuff like that. There's nothing that it's asking you to. It's all fetch quests. Sorry?
Okay, go on.
Sorry?
There's a Novak Djokovic joke.
No, go on, repeat that. Repeat the joke again, Matt. Let's all hear
no,
it.
No, it's fine. It was a Novak Djokovic joke. It was, yeah, I mean, some people are cracking up now.
So then you just keep doing these missions, you build up your inventory, and you start building your camp up, and that's pretty much it. It's got online, you can do it in co-op and stuff, but I tried to do some co-op last night, and unless you're at the same level as the people you're playing against, you can't, it doesn't appear that you can go on the missions that they're doing alongside them, because you still need to unlock stuff. So I found myself entering a game with three other people in it, going up to where they were going on to their next mission, not having the option to do it, so just picking the last mission on that list and just going off on my own. It was kind of like, all right, okay. It's like being back at school where everyone else is just more popular and getting, you know, I just have to go in the corner and play with a tennis ball on my Todd. But
with Novak.
Yeah. I've still got to play it for a lot longer, but right now it feels just a bit 6 out of 10, if you know what I mean. There's nothing really standing out for me. And although I like what they've done with the building the camp stuff is a piece of piss to do, and the survival stuff is a piece of piss. It looks like it's got layers to it, but at the base level, it is really simple, and you don't have to, you know, freak out about bars constantly going down. But at the same time, if that's all it is, then that's not very good. Because if the combat's not exciting, if the combat's not fun, then what am I playing this for? So that's that game.
Do you think it would have been better if they called it How to Survive?
I thought that, Matt. I thought exactly that about 14 times. And then what was the reason I got... I think I come to the conclusion, though, it's better the way they did it, but I can't remember how I got there. It was kind of like, How to Survive sounds like it could still be like the first one, game.
I would have liked it if it, instead of how the number two survive, it's How to Survive 2, but T00. Almost like Look Who's Talking Now, Look Who's, you know, that sort of stuff. How to Survive Now.
How to Survive. Yeah, very funny. Matt, what you been playing?
Speaking of zombie games, I played the Resident Evil 7 demo.
Oh, yeah.
Virtual reality.
The demo.
I did it. I actually, it took me a while. Took me 3 nights, but I got through it in the end.
Why did it take you 3 nights?
Because it was too scary, and I kept having to stop playing.
Okay, so what moments were you at the point where, like, you had to turn it off? What happened to make you go? The first night, take me through your first night on that demo.
First night, I got out of the room. So basically, it's a really super short demo. You could put the whole thing in, like, 6 minutes, if that. If you want to do, like, if you want to get the bad ending, that is, there are other things you can do in the demo. But, yeah, even just putting the headset on, I was like, oh, fucking hell, this is way too much. It's just... Yeah, it's way, way too much. But I managed to get out of the room, and there's no puzzle. You literally just have to walk forward. But then when you get out of the room, it's like a really long, there's like a long dark hallway, and you can hear sounds above you. And it's just, there was a doorway to your left, and I just was convinced something was going to burst out and get me. Nothing did. That was night one. Night two, I was like, okay, I know how to get out of the room. I can do this. And I went into the kitchen. The kitchen's fine. There's like a really unnerving sense of dread, of a sense that something's going to get you. You can hear sounds up above, and I was like, oh God, I know this is VR, so what they're going to do is they're going to like turn around. I'm going to turn around, suddenly it's going to be like something in my face. That didn't happen. So I was playing it. I was like, you know, really, really rather scared of it. And my wife Jill thought it'd be funny to go, you know, like to make me jump.
Because, oh God, that is horrific.
She thought, oh, it's not really that scary. And I was like, fucking hell, Jill, are you serious? I was so angry.
I'm in a different reality.
I was so angry. I was like, look, I'm not joking. She goes, well, what's so scary about it? I was like, do you want me to have a go? She goes, no, I don't want to have a go. It's like, geez, don't do that to me. I hate being made jump anyway. And, oh, yeah, so that was annoying.
Matt, what has your life become now?
Oh, no, it's bad. I'm in virtual reality.
No, Jill!
I've opened a fridge, Jill. It's scary.
That is rule one of virtual reality. You don't do that to somebody.
You shock a man with a headset on.
So if I was in the Matrix, you wouldn't just pull the cord out, would you? Jesus.
I could be like those, man. Yeah, so that was really bad. But I managed to finish it. I'm so proud I did. Although there's one bit which absolutely shit me up. And all that happened was I turned around and a mannequin fell over. But I was like, oh, my God. It really, really super made me jump. It was horrific. But yeah, I got through. I got the bad ending. I was too scared to go upstairs. There's like an upstairs you can go to. I was too scared to do it. So I got the bad ending, which basically means you get got at the end of the demo. But I'm sure I can go back into it, go upstairs and get a key or do whatever I need to do. But it's so unnerving. I think John Denton said he would send me the full game. So John, if listening, send it over. But I think if he does, and I do get to play that, it will take me potentially weeks and months to get through it, because I just had to keep pausing. I said to Jill numerous times, okay, that's it, I'm done. I can't do it. I took my headset off, and I was like, okay, I'll go back in for 10 seconds. And even though it was really, you know, it was far too intense, I didn't actually play it in non-VR mode once. I guess I could have done. But it felt like VR was the right way to play this demo. But even on the day, the morning before I'd even finished it, I was excited to go back to it, even though I knew it would really scare me. So I really, really want to play the full game. And although I hear the first hour is really, really bad, there's just loads of jump scares and stuff, I think I've done the demo and hopefully I should be able to handle the full game. But it's just so intense. I think it looks fantastic as well in VR. It looks great. It sounds great. Yeah, it's really, really fucking scary. Because it is, you're basically in like a freaky haunted house with scary stairs and noises and stuff. And if I was in a real house, it would freak me out. But
Two things. First, don't hold your breath with John. I mean, he said to me the other day, oh, do you want to borrow Watch Dogs 2? I'm still waiting on that. In fact, actually, he said, do you want to borrow Watch Dogs 2, David? I went, yeah. James been raving about it. I'll try it out. Nah, actually, you wouldn't bother. Yeah, I wouldn't bother if I were you. You wouldn't like it. Oh, okay. Secondly... if Jill would turn around to you and said that the bloke in the office, a bloke in her office, had completed Resident Evil 7, would you? That made you instantly put the helmet back on.
Yes. I was like, Tony's done what?
I'm having this.
Tony from the council's done what, the prick? I'm going to finish on hard.
It just shows you how mental we are.
But the weird thing about playing in VR is that obviously it feels more real because that's the whole deal with VR, but I felt like I was doing things that maybe in real life I would also do. If I saw a doorway, I thought, okay, suck yourself up, Matt, and just like bombed a doorway. And I feel like if I was just playing the game without VR, I don't know if I'd play it that way. I would just probably play it more as like a regular game, but I felt like I was playing more as if I was how I would react in real life. Apparently,
I think regular games can simulate that though, because I totally got that with Gone Home. Like, every time I walked into a room, I was like, where's the light switch?
Yeah, no, I definitely did that in Gone Home. But the thing with Gone Home is that I wouldn't have, in real life, crawled around the outside and opened every single drawer. And so, for me, Gone Home didn't feel realistic. I think if I played Gone Home maybe in VR, maybe I would have done things differently. But I also definitely did the whole light switch thing because Gone Home also scared me quite a lot. But yeah. Resi 7, it looks great, and I'm eager to play the full game.
Oh God, you got to film that.
It does. Apparently, does lay off with the pure scare stuff.
Yeah, I hear it's the first hours it's got a lot of scare things. It's got jump scares and whatnot. But after that, it goes into much more standard Resident Evil stuff. And
yeah,
obviously you can play the whole game in VR. But I was talking to John Denton, and he said that it's fine and really good. But in the combat scenarios, it's not as responsive. Obviously, in terms of turning, you have it has that sort of 30-degree circle thing where if you press right on the right stick, it just moves in 30-degree increments. I think you can turn it off. And when I was playing Robinson on PSVR, I turned it off and I was just playing as you would do a regular FPS. So maybe it's just a case of getting used to it. But yeah, it could be that combat scenarios are way too intense in VR. But yeah, I think I'll try and give it a go. It will take me years potentially. It's way, way too intense. As well as that, I've played a little bit of Doom. I just played another level, so I haven't got an awful lot to say about that. But Doom actually surprised me. When even the second level, there's a lot more verticality than I thought Doom would have. I mean, I haven't really seen much of this game. I've tried to avoid it, but it really impressed me how much you can like jump around the level to get sort of height on enemies. And there was quite a lot to do. For some reason, in my head, I thought it'd be a super simple sort of corridor shooter. But I'm enjoying what I'm playing so far of Doom.
Oh no, it really opens up later on. As I said, it was, you know, about when you get to hell, I think it really starts to go full on Quake Arena sort of maps. Mm. You know what I mean? That's one of the best bits about it, I think.
Yeah. Still playing Fire Emblem Heroes. I think I'm really? Probably yeah. I finished the game on normal, and now I'm 2/3 of the way through the game on hard. I'm still loving it. Well, I think I'm maybe coming to the end. I had one amazing pull where I got like a couple of 5-star characters and life was great. I've had two rubbish pulls. And what's happening is because I'm 2/3 of the way through the game on hard. That means I'm definitely coming towards the end of the amount of orbs I can earn. Especially in the main story. Once I'm through the story, then I'll have to rely on when they release special maps and special little events to earn orbs, rather than obviously having to pay for it.
So what do the orbs do?
So with orbs, you can summon new characters, basically. It's best to save up 20 because it works out cheaper to summon 5 characters, 20 orbs versus 25. But basically, once you have 5 or above, you can start summoning characters. I've got a good selection of characters right now. I've got a couple of 5-stars, a couple of 4-stars, so I'm really enjoying it, and it's really fun playing the harder maps because I think there is a bit more strategy involved. It's still nothing like what the real game is meant to be, and this is obviously the maps are really small and rather basic, but I'm really enjoying playing it on slightly more tough difficulties. I think it's great. I've only paid one more microtransaction, only one more. I think it's £2.99 I paid. So I paid £6 in total. And for the amount of play I've got, I think that's fair. Although I've already had Jill asking me what these things are coming off the joint account. She said, "Well, what is this stuff off the joint account?" It says iTunes £2.49. I was like, "Oh, that's iCloud. We need that for our photo storage." What's this one? 79p? Yeah, that's iCloud. We need it for our storage. What's this one? £1.99. That's a game. And she goes, "Oh, what game?" Oh, Fire Emblem. I've got it's a paid app. I've got to buy it. There's another one here for £1.99 as well. Week after, yeah, that was another one. That was another game. So if anyone sees Jill, she thinks Fire Emblem's a paid game. Don't tell her the truth.
What's this one for £15? There's a new Kanye West album.
I had to get it. It was really good.
Well, why does it say £69.99 for orbs?
Sorry, orbs.
That's porn.
Yeah, it is. I had to buy some porn. It's a hot new artist, Orbs. Have you heard the album? It's brilliant. Yeah, but no, I'm still playing it. It's still the thing. I play fairly routine through a day. It's still really fun doing the hard levels. I haven't actually bothered playing the arena stuff. The arena is where you can, you basically create a team and you've got to try and win 7 in a row, and you get a certain amount of points for that. And at the end of the week, they give you they give you feathers, and you can use that to upgrade players. But I haven't even tried doing the arena stuff yet, but. I'm still enjoying it, but I feel like I'm probably coming to the end once those orbs run out. The other thing I've been playing is Rocket League, but we've all played Rocket League this week.
We'll start. We'll move over to James then, because it was James's first Rocket League game. What was it? Last night?
No, Sunday.
Night before.
Yeah.
Was it Saturday?
Saturday night. Yeah. So James, what did you make of Rocket League?
Well, the thing is, you see, I bought this ages ago, and we kept meaning to play it and didn't get around to it. But then you've been going on about this for years as well. Like, how long has it been out for?
It's 2015 it came out.
Yeah, okay, so it's like about 2 years or whatever. But it's kind of everything that you said it was.
Yes, it is.
It's pretty much amazing. And, I mean, the thing that I really liked about it is it's actually pretty easy to get into. Like, as in...
Yeah.
You can like grasp it quite quickly, like what you need to do. I mean, I found myself doing a lot of goal hanging, as you can see in that video, which there was that brilliant.
What was your name? The one yard hero, yeah, or something.
It works though, doesn't it? But I think the thing that I like about it is, I mean, I still by the end of it, I mean, we played for a couple of hours, and I still didn't feel like I had complete control at all, like over my car, like as in driving around. That's fine, but still trying to, like, you know, hit the ball in the right places and everything. I still didn't have that, but.
But you shouldn't have that. That's the thing. I mean, you shouldn't have complete control. I've not got complete control yet, and I've put a ridiculous amount of hours into that game.
But you've still got a higher level than I've got at the moment. But
because I've spent so many hours playing it. Yeah,
but it's like, but the thing I really liked about it is because there is so sort of many sort of like random amazing moments that happen with it that. Because of the fact that it doesn't feel like you've got complete control, it doesn't feel completely random, but it's just crazy stuff happens and it's brilliant and it's just like unexpected things. And it always feels like there's this, like, even when we played those competitive games right at the end, it still felt like there was a chance we could win, like we could get back into it, which was really good.
Yeah, it's an amazing game, Rocket League. And there's a video of us for all played on Saturday night, and Dave edited a video. It's on our YouTube channel, so just search it on there.
What I will say is that it's a better representation of playing football than any football game I've ever played before, because you're not flicking the ball between players. That's not strictly true, because there's size of pairs in FIFA that this game obviously can't represent. But the idea is that there's how to kick the ball. Like, you know when you go into a park, you know how to kick a ball. You pull your leg back, you kick it. Right? You know how to move that ball forward. But it's like there's still that opportunity that you're going to miss or you're going to fuck up.
Yeah.
And then you slowly start building up tactics. Like, when we were playing quite regularly, myself and Matt used to have great... sort of, we knew where each other was on the pitch, so I knew that he'd be rushing into the back post whenever I'd like knock the ball towards there and stuff. And the communication went. It's funny because it happened as well on Saturday night, where at the start of when we were playing, we were just constantly chatting to each other, and by the end, it was like one word commands to each other. You know what I mean? And then that's what it does. You feel like you're pulling together as a team, and it. I mean, it certainly helped that we were battering teams left, right and centre. 11-2, we beat one team. I mean, it was insane. It would appear that the only groups of mates that aren't really into Rocket League are playing four-player versus four-player. But, when we moved over to three-player, we were still holding our own. I think we lost the first game, but the second game we absolutely smashed the team. So... yeah, that game is just too good. We've got to do more of that because I had so much fun on Saturday night.
Yeah,
genuine fun.
Yeah.
Really good laughter and just, yeah, it was just really good fun to play.
What do you think, Sean? Because you haven't played it much either, have you?
No, like I played a bit when it first came out and it's just always been sort of sat there like, yes, yeah, really fucking play Rocket League. Rocket League's really good. And sort of assumed it had got to the point where there was no point like a new player joining in, you know, like most games that, you know, with a heavy sort of, because, you know, this has quite a solid competitive scene and stuff that you figure that anyone who's still playing it by this point, like, really fucking knows what they're doing. But didn't feel like that at all. We were winning loads of games. I know we were playing a bit of a joke mode, weren't we? Because we had four of us, which is not proper Rocket League. But yeah, we were doing all right.
I mean, the matchmaking in that game, we said this when we were playing, the matchmaking in that game is so good. It's so good. And that beginners can, you know, get into the game, because it's not that it's just being played. It's not like most games that have lasted this long where it's just been played by people that really know their shit. People are still picking it up. You know what I mean? Yeah. And it's still, you will find games at your level the moment you log in. Well, maybe when you your first few games where you don't really know what's going on, you'll struggle. But soon enough, the game will put you in, matchmake you with people just as shit as you.
There's tons of DLC and stuff, but it's all been done in such a way that you don't feel excluded. Like, there's nothing that is essential to you actually just getting in and playing the game.
No, although I totally agree, and I shouldn't be angry at this, and I guess I'm not, but the way they're doing DLC now is a bit weird. For those of you that haven't played Rocket League for a while, I logged on, won a game, and it said, congratulations, you've won a... What did they call it? A champion's chest or something, a champion's package. And I opened it up and I thought, hey, there's some cool stuff in here. That boost effect looks finally like I can change it away from like the flamethrower thing that I've been using since launch day. I might use that. So I went to select it and it went, yeah, £1.50. And I was like, what?
But I just also, opened the chest. When you do that, it's not, you don't actually get all those things either, do you? It's like, it could have these things in. It's like it's...
well, yeah, which is fine if you didn't have to pay for the individual exactly, items as well. It's really weird.
But I mean, the only thing I would say about it is that I can't imagine playing this with just random people. Like, I'd want to play this with people I know. I can't imagine playing it with just randoms.
I do it all the time.
Really? What's it like?
And I enjoy it. I enjoy it. Not equally. I take it for some reason, I take it a lot more seriously when I'm playing with randoms. But yeah, I play it all the time. It's my just before I go to bed game. If I played a game for a long time, I'll have a quick game of Rocket League before I go to bed. Just go on to free, because they've got a game mode which I love it when they do this. I think Call of Duty did it first, where it makes sure that it doesn't put you up against a team and only puts you up against other single players looking for a free-on-free game of Rocket League. I think it's called... standard solo mode or something. You never come across like some clan that will just absolutely tear you to pieces. But at the same time, you do come across a lot of people that call you out in the little chat at the top left-hand corner. Drunken Elmo, you're shit. Drunken Elmo, you're shit. It's like, all right, mate.
I just tend to reply, wow. Before bed, because after we'd finished with that, I couldn't get to sleep for ages because I was still kind of buzzing from it.
Really? Why?
Yeah, it's exciting, isn't it? And it's like... it didn't feel like a wind down game at all. Like, it just felt, winding up.
Yeah, I was fucking wired after we played it. That was when I stayed up till 3 a.m. and finished Fire Emblem.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
You should have stayed on. We had a couple.
We stopped playing because you were going to bed. But the worst thing is if you say, okay, let's stay on until we win a match, and then it can be long ting.
Oh God, yeah, we've had a few of those nights. I'm not going to bed until we win. And then all of a sudden it's like 3 a.m. You're like, no, I'm still definitely not going to bed until we win.
Yeah, it's still an incredible game. And it's also it's also great because, Sean, obviously you're not into football. You're not saying onto football like James, myself and Dave are, but it's still fun. Mm-hmm. You don't have to love football. It's just a great, fun game.
No, absolutely regardless. Not. Yeah, totally.
You'd like football if you didn't, if you weren't such a dick. Right, what else have you been playing, James?
Well, Yakuza 0, but there's not really much to say about it beyond like what I've already said last week. I mean, it's amazing.
Your review's gone up. It has, given it a 10.
It's my game of the year so far, and mostly because, I mean, at this stage...
because it's February. Go on.
No, this is going to be... This feels like another Shenmue to me, to be honest. I'm thinking about it when I'm playing it.
Is it a good thing or a bad thing?
It's a good thing, Matt. It's a good thing. It's...
just had a check.
You're not going to come round with a DVD with all the cutscenes next time you come over, are you, James, and try and make me watch it?
No, I'm not going to make that mistake ever again.
Please don't do that.
This is the other thing is I'm kind of like, because I said I'd lend it to you, but I'm kind of like hesitant to do that now because this is becoming another one of those games that I just really, really love. And I don't want you to play it and just be like, this is rubbish. And it's just...
Well, we've got something in common then, because I'm always hesitant to lend you a game anymore, James. Fucking hell. Never get it back.
That's for the exact different reasons, though, isn't it? It's...
but before you go on, James, speaking of Shenmue, I flicked through a Games Master magazine today. I don't know why. I just was shocked to see it was still actually in publication. And in next month's issue, which is out on the 23rd of February, whatever, they say they've got a preview of Shenmue and Shenmue 3. And how is that even possible? I mean... maybe they're sharing code with magazines and they're not sharing it with like Kickstarter back as well.
Games Master magazine in the UK.
They had like three screenshots and that was it. But apparently Games Master are previewing the game next month. So I'm very much looking forward to it.
Almost
that.
Definitely a lie.
Yeah, I can believe it. A preview, amazing. Oh no, wait, it's not pointing out for another two or three years, but
they're fighting for their life against the internet, Matt.
We're reviewing.
They'll say anything at this point.
But no, it's still amazing, the game. the game is still like amazing. I mean, it's mostly because now the story's like really started to kick in, and it feels, like I said in my review, it feels like a really good like drama series now. And I don't know. I mean, recently I just found that Underground Women's Wrestling Club, which is pretty cool. So it's amazing.
You need help, James. Anyone that wants us to review their game on Spong.com, make sure James gets hold of it and just put, like, scantily clad women
in there.
It's
not like that. It's not. Guaranteed if 10. If you read the review, that's not the reason why I gave it a 10. But it's superb. It's, yeah.
You play it for the articles. We know, James. Jesus.
I play it for the side missions. It's brilliant. Anyway.
Sure.
But then the only other thing I've played is I've been playing, like, Super Mario 3D World again. And, I mean, I went back to this mostly because of my daughter, because she can play it, like, pretty competently now. And it's... Have you played it recently, Dave?
I play it every weekend, mate.
But you...
I have to. I've got no choice.
I mean, but you can't play it in co-op yet, can you? Like,
I have to play it in co-op, James. I've got no choice.
Right. Okay. But you can't, like, complete levels and stuff like that, you know, like...
I can't. Well, this is the cool thing about... Nintendo games, isn't it? I do complete levels. The whole game turns into me just picking up Luigi and taking him to the end. It's like I'm playing Ico. It's exactly the same as that. I'm constantly battling against a useless co-op partner and have to try and somehow work out a way of chucking Luigi to the other end of that platform. You know, it's been difficult, but we have got 20 is how I've played the whole game from start to finish. I need 14 more green stars before I can fight Bowser to finish the game, technically. So we're nearly at the end again.
So that's pretty amazing, though. I mean, but this is what has like really made me sort of appreciate like how well it's designed, because like, I mean, Rachel, like, she can play games, but like not like really, really well yet. And like, the whole, like, drop-in and drop-out stuff is brilliant. And also the bubble stuff is, you know, like, when it gets, like, really tough, she can just go into the bubble and it's not so much of a problem. But there's a brilliant, like, difficulty curve. I mean, she's totally obsessed with it at the moment. I mean, she was before when she used to watch me play. But now she's doing it herself. She gets... I can really tell she's, like, feeling like this massive accomplishment when she finishes stuff. And, I mean, she started playing 3D Land on the 2DS now, like, on her own. And she, like, finished the first world without any help at all. And she just came to show me and she was just so proud. And I don't know, I just felt so good about that. Because, I mean, she's grown up playing, like, iPad games and, like, some Animal Crossing stuff. And it really feels brilliant to, like, watch her play, like, proper games and really connect with them. And this is the first time I've seen her, like, really do that. Like, really connect with something which I feel is, like, a really, like, high-quality game. And it's awesome to see that.
Also, you can't, I mean, you got to respect Nintendo the first time you see a two-year-old watch Mario pick up one of those double cherry things.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it blew his mind. Like, oh, there's Mario there, and he's going towards that cherry, fine. Oh my god, there's two of them. What do I do now? There's two Marios running next. There's three of them now. I've watched his, like, it was like his brain was melting and coming out of his ears as he was, like, pushing his hands towards his skull because he could not quite believe what was going on the television. It was one of my favourite gaming moments of all time, watching that. It was great. I mean, that was what he did, and then now he's used to it. He just goes, two of the same? Yeah, two of the same, Harry. Yeah, please just shut up. I just need to get to the end of this. It's amazing how quickly that cute stuff becomes irritating, isn't it?
Yep.
Yeah, it's a good game. We've spoken about it on this podcast, haven't we?
Yeah, but it's just nice game to play it, like, in a different way. Like, for me, this has been, like, yeah, it appreciate it in a different sort of way. It's good.
It's all that cool shit as well that's hidden away. Like, you know, as I said before, the crown, and that you can knock the crown off your mate's head and put it on. And if you pick up a star, invincibility star, you can just, like, if you touch the other co-op partners, it makes them invisible as well. Also, with going back to the cherries, if you get a cherry, say I got a cherry and Harry got a cherry, says two Luigis and two Marios, I could jump on one of the Luigis and nick him and turn him into Mario and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
All the little shit that's in there like that is just like, yeah, you thought about this, didn't you? You've literally sat down and thought about what people want to do and say, that's my favourite thing with Nintendo games, is when you go, I wonder what happens if I do this, and they've thought about it and given some sort of benefit for doing it.
But you see,
they're brilliant at that shit.
This is one of the other things, though, that I really think is brilliant about the Wii U. Like, there are so many games like this that you can just play co-op, you know, and it's really easy to just sort of get into and, like, drop in or drop out and play. And I just really hope that, like, Mario Odyssey is going to have, like, this as well. You know, where you can just play two players easily, you know, like this in the same kind of way.
That would be amazing. Yeah.
I think there's a really high chance.
There is literally no way that Mario Odyssey is going to be disappointing. I'm going to say it now. There's no chance it's going to happen. It's going to be fantastic. Mm-hmm. I can't wait. I've watched that bloody trailer about 50 times now. I still like the look of it, so I can't wait. I still think, right, okay, going back to Odyssey a minute. It is weird that there's, like, real people there, right?
Yeah, it is weird.
Yeah.
Why didn't they just make the Mario-style... Because at first I thought, well, he's come from the Mushroom Kingdom. He's not going to look like people from the real world. But no, the actual Mario story is that he came from the real world. So
is that canon?
Oh, we don't know what's going with this. It's ridiculous.
I thought that's always been like the standard story, right? So he's a plumber from not New York, was it? It must have been Italy.
That's from the cartoon. I don't think that's definitely not canon.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Is it? But so he was born and brought up in the Mushroom Kingdom.
Because if Yoshi's Island is canon, which I assume it is, then he was delivered by a stork. There you go.
Oh, right, that makes sense, because the other thing I was going to say was that Princess Peach wasn't at any point living in the real world, and she looks like Mario.
She was in the Bob Hoskins film. Yeah, that was.
I still think they should have been taken New York and Mario'd it. You know what I mean? It's just a little bit weird that they're real people walking about. And at first, when people were saying that, I was going, oh, shut up. Like, who cares? That now I care, because I've watched that trailer about 50 times, and it is still that skipping rope bit is still a bit weird.
It's still the Sonic Adventure thing, isn't it? It still looks a bit like that, which is not.
Yeah, that doesn't help.
Good.
But I've got a little bit more faith in Nintendo than that. Yeah. But at the same time, skipping rope thing's weird.
Oh yeah, I doubt there's going to be like a Big the Cat, you know, in this. It's it'd be good.
Big the Cat.
Yeah.
Was he one of Sonic's friends?
Yeah, he was one of the cat friends.
Amazing fishing mini game.
Yeah.
Yep.
Right, okay, what we got in terms of emails and tweets then, James?
We got a fair bit. If you want to email us, it's thecomputergameshow@gmail.com. And the first one is from Lee Knight. It says, hey lads, please can you do my quick fire round the table for us listeners? We need to know more about our leaders at TCGS. So, these are just some quick fire questions. We got 2D or 3D platformers?
3D.
It doesn't matter, does it?
It's not the game,
just answer the question.
2D.
There's probably more good 2D ones than 3D ones.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. 2D. Yeah.
Yep, 2D. Disc or cart?
Disc or cart?
Cartridge.
Cart.
Probably fond of that.
Oh, cartridge. Cartridge.
Matt?
I say cartridge.
Okay, I'll go for disc. Tits or ass? Sorry.
Hang on, you go for disc. CD or vinyl?
Oh, yeah, sorry. Yeah, sorry, I'll skip one. CD or vinyl?
CD.
Yep.
Really? Do you still actually buy and play CDs?
No, I don't buy vinyl.
Do you still actually buy and play vinyls, Sean?
Yeah, but if I had to buy an album in physical form, I'd rather have vinyl than
piss
CD.
Off.
And that's not me being like a throwback muso cunt. That's just to me a CD is just like a pointless halfway house between vinyl and Spotify.
It's an easier way of getting music onto your phone.
But what's easier is the Spotify account you already have, Dave, or Apple Music, or whatever.
See, this is why Chris Spann has a go at you every time you do this shit on Midnight Resistance. Like, we're not, Spotify's not in this. CD or vinyl.
This is a quick fire round. Can we just
get to
it?
Fucking,
honestly.
I'm just trying to put off getting to the next one because it's...
This is an easy one for me. The next one, go on.
Tits or ass?
Tits.
Yeah, I concur. Matt?
Yeah. Yep, next question.
Sean, well, actually, I like the midriff. Go on.
It depends, doesn't it? It's not that simple.
Fuck off. Answer the question.
No, it depends who you're talking about.
I'm talking about you.
I want to hear
tits
more.
Sure, we're not letting you get away with this. You're going to answer.
Well, but if I, okay, between my arse and my tits, I'd say my arse is naked.
Shut up. Sean, can you just answer the question, please? Please.
No.
Why not? Are you more of a tits man or are you more of an arse man?
Probably arse, I suppose.
There we go. Right. Simple as that. Now, if you would have gone there, we would have saved time. Okay. To bed earlier.
Paper mag or e-mag?
Paper mag?
Yeah, I'll go for
paper mag all the way. Also, who calls it an e-mag? Jesus.
What do you mean?
E-mag. It just sounds like something from the 90s.
No, yeah, but they did exist, though, right? They were everyone tried them at one point.
Well, no, I mean, they people still trying
again,
them.
Again, okay,
e-mag.
Quick fire.
Sorry,
can e-mag? We just...
What are they called, Matt? This is your thing.
Yeah, I wouldn't call them e-mag, because I just call them digital magazines or whatever.
E-mag is short.
E-mag. It is shorter.
To be fair.
It sounds so horrible, 90s. Go on.
would you hyphenate it, Matt? Would it be e-mag, or is it just going to be e-mag? Yeah.
I think you'd have to, because it's not like email. But anyway, next question.
BMW or I-mag. Audi?
Oh, that's a tough one.
Audi,
I honestly legitimately don't care about this one. I've no opinion either way.
Just say one,
say
then.
A word.
BMW.
Right, Audi. Definitely Audi. Yeah.
It's tough because I've always wanted a 5 Series, but the Audi A5 is a better looking car right now, so I'm going to go Audi.
It's classier.
Bourbons or custard creams? It's got to be Bourbons.
Bourbons.
Mm.
Custard creams, mate.
I mean, neither...
I'm a biscuit racist.
I'm going to go Bourbons.
Okay. Glasses or contacts? I've no idea because I don't wear them, but I'd probably go for glasses because I hate the idea of everything's in my eyes.
Fuck putting tiny bits of plastic or glass or whatever they are into
my
eye.
Yeah, I'm not keen on that.
Glasses. Yeah.
Glasses all the way.
Aviators. Mirrored aviators.
Okay, and then the big one, SNES or Mega Drive?
Mega Drive.
SNES.
This is a really tough one, actually.
No, it's not.
No, it isn't. It's SNES.
It is, isn't it? It's
Sega
got to be
Genesis.
Yes.
I didn't own a SNES.
My brother had a SNES. I had a Mega Drive, right? I was a Mega Drive child. My first internet name was Sega Dude. SNES is the answer to this question.
Okay, anyway, next one we got is from Capone. He says, could James please describe the sexy video he watched on Yakuza? What happens in it?
Yes, please
no.
do.
Anyway,
no, please
next
do.
One.
I want to
hear James, go on.
There's nothing to explain. It's just a video, you know?
Tell us what happens.
Well, the really thing that's really weird about it is because you pick up these...
I
don't want to explain this.
You're not
one
out.
Can we move on?
Well, you're going to have to.
All right, well, you pick up these cards in the game, right?
I bet you
and
do.
And then you can go to these, like, special viewing areas.
I bet you do.
So you go to... It gets worse. Seriously, it gets worse. Because, you know, you go in there and they say, which one do you want to watch? So you have a look. You watch one of the videos and it's like a fully... Like, it's not... Like a rendered video, it's a real video, and it's not so good. And then,
happens? No, what's so good? What happens in it?
No, it's just soft. It's just nothing. You don't. Oh, you don't tell us.
Just explain what it
James,
is.
James, why are you getting all coy about this?
Because there's
what
nothing to tell you. Seriously,
just explain it.
I'll tell you what, Dave. I'll send you the video later because I did record one.
Describe it on the podcast now.
Send it to me for purposes of the show, but.
Imagine Babe Station.
Go
okay.
On. Okay, but... you have me at Babe Station.
But
we all watched it at Sean's wedding, didn't we? Go on.
But with less nudity, and that's what you got.
I need this game.
What? With less nudity?
Yeah, less nudity. Yeah.
It's a woman on the phone.
Is she doing that thing where she pretends she wants you to get her to ring her? She like wiggles the phone.
Yeah, she's holding her hand up to her ear. Okay, come on, James.
Yeah. No, it's not like that. It's just playing with balloons or whatever. You know, it's just ridiculous. But anyway,
how much money have you spent on premium numbers this week, James?
At one point in the video, does it say, oh, if you want to text, it's like 16 quid to see my... You know, does that happen in Yakuza?
it doesn't matter, no. Okay. But then the funny thing is then once the video ends, it pans over, like your field of view pans over, and there's like a box of tissues like next to the TV, and then he just goes like that.
In the game,
40 minutes in real life.
No, this is in the game. But it's
do you know what would be brilliant is if you were watching it, and then it suddenly turned the camera on, like your Kinect or your PlayStation yeah. camera, and just showed you sitting there.
Just snaps pictures, sticks it on your What's New feed.
There's James fumbling, getting his jeans up. Like, Jim, don't come James down, cock out. I'm playing a game.
Matt, before we move on, do you want to explain why that question was asked?
No.
Because you've discovered that James had a achievement for watching these videos.
What's brilliant about that is the name of the trophy is "I did it for the trophy," and it's like that's the reason.
And we all know
you
didn't.
But yeah, it's
there's a picture
but...
of James's achievement on our Instagram feed. If you want to go find that, it was quite funny to find that discovery. Like, James, Jesus Christ, this is good.
I'm really surprised it took you so long, to be honest, because it had happened about a week earlier, and I'd have thought you'd have noticed.
Jesus, I think that says everything about PlayStation's What's New tab.
Yeah, not so new. Anyway, let's move on.
No, you need to do a joke before you do the ba-dum-tsh sound, James.
Anyway.
There needs to be a joke there.
The next one we got is from You Never Walk Alone, which I assume that's the name. The first part of the email is mostly him just slagging me off, and so I'm going to move on to the actual...
What do you mean?
Well, it's just... I don't know, I've deleted it. So I'm just going to move on to the main question.
You deleted it?
What do you mean slagging me off? He's a listener. We've got to respect his...
it's just him saying I'm boring and yeah, that kind of thing. So,
go on.
He's got a point.
I thought I'd move on to the next bit, which is, so my question. I've got two kids, 10 and 6, who like games and we enjoy a fair bit of couch co-op together. I'm due a bonus from works, so should have a fair bit of cash. So my question is, should I get a PS4 Pro, I have a PS4 and could get a 4K gaming going, or keep my Switch pre-order and introduce my kids to games on Nintendo? I originally thought Switch, but now I think maybe I should double down on PlayStation and benefit from a better quality experience on Horizon and Mass Effect. So, what do we think?
So, you combated him calling you boring by cutting out the interesting part of that email and reading that bit.
Pretty much,
I think you're being generous.
I would say, quite clearly, you should get a Switch over a PS4 Pro. Because, I mean, especially if you've got kids.
And if he's already got a PS4, yeah, fuck it.
It's a bit of a shame that there's not much that you can play.
Yeah, if you want to get something that plays Nintendo games, there's quite a lot of them around and it's cheap. Get a Wii U. There you go.
I don't think they're that cheap, though, right?
Still cheaper than a Switch.
Is it sure there's going to be loads in CEX pretty soon?
We'll see. I mean, my brother bought one at the weekend. My brother bought one at Christmas, and it was £200.
Ouch.
Yeah,
I think. He hasn't said whether he's got a 4K TV. There's maybe like if you have, maybe there's a bit more reason to get it. But from the sounds of it, yeah, I would just I would get a Switch. You know, and then you've already got a PS4. Horizon Mass Effect will still look great without the Pro.
Also, you're not getting Horizon and Mass Effect for the kids, are you? Let's face it. This is an email that's basically saying, should I be selfish or not?
Yeah.
Probably shouldn't, mate. just get yourself a Switch for the kids. And then when you can afford it. If you get a PS4 Pro, right, it's still going to be really hard to get to play it because the kids are about. If you get them a Switch, sit them in the corner with a Switch, you can play your PlayStation 4 a lot more. Think about these things, yeah? Fucking cunning plan, Lid. So get on that. Also, going back to my brother buying a Wii U for £200, that was the price that James talked me out of buying a Wii U a year after it came out for £200 with two games. So cheers for that, James. Appreciate your help, as usual.
No problem. Anyway, next one is from John Bernard Timmons. He says, I do think James gets a bit of a hard time, even if he does express some proclivity for scantily clad manga females and Animal Crossing characters. I don't know where that's come from. But anyway, I'm relatively new to the South, from Scotland, and recall you talking about how you met. Would you ever consider a meet and greet drink with listeners at a place like the Loading Bar?
Absolutely not.
Okay.
Next question. No, I'm not joking.
I know. That's why it's funny, Dave.
I don't know what I can say.
No one wants to meet us. Let's move on.
We might do a live show at one point.
What? This is news to me.
It shouldn't be. I've spoken to you about it before.
I'm joking.
Good. Next question.
Okay, Ms. Rangers says, good evening, gentlemen. Have you or do you ever buy a game before reviews are released? Do you have any regrets over the years when you jumped in headfirst only to regret it? For me, the only time I purchased prior to reviews was Just Cause 3, and that game came out broken. Yes, eventually fixed, but ended up being one of my least played games of this generation.
I mean, it's pretty hard to buy games before reviews, generally, because generally reviews come out before the games come out.
But not with pre-orders and stuff, I guess.
There is that.
I know you can still cancel.
Yeah, you can always cancel the pre-order.
I mean, what you do get, though, is you get, like, sometimes you get, like, really positive initial buzz, and then everyone sort of jumps on it, and then later people are like, actually, this wasn't very good. I'm thinking, like, No Man's Sky. You know, it's like, I got that because I thought it was going to... I mean, that's one of the reasons I bought a PS4. And then it turned out...
There wasn't that much buzz about it.
There was. Come on. When it came people were well excited when it just before it came out. And then it came out...
Just before it came out, definitely. But when it came out, it was pretty quickly panned, right?
I don't know. I think it was a couple of weeks at least of, like, of positivity.
No. It was way before that the negativity started.
Really?
Way before it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Easily within the first week. I mean, the reviews weren't exactly glowing. And then it just went downhill from there. I think... it's rare that I actually go out and buy games before they come out anymore. But I would have no problem. No, it's because I don't buy games anymore. I get sent them for free. That's one of the perks of having this amount of talent. I would have no money. I would have no problem dropping money on Mass Effect Andromeda before the reviews come in. Absolutely no. If I wasn't, I think I'm reviewing that game. If I wasn't reviewing that game, and I would already have a pre-order, I'd already pay for it, definitely. Because it's a risk. It's a risk you take. But at the end of the day, you can claw some of that money back if you sell the disc on quick enough. But it's just that game I'm so excited for that I would jump in early. And other games as well, like, Titanfall 2 I definitely would have bought early and all that sort of stuff. So, there are still games that I'm quite happy to lay a bit of money down first and just not give a shit about what the reviews say. Just want to play them myself.
And I very rarely buy them, like, full price when they first come out. It's just too expensive. Like, I mean, I wanted to buy Mass Effect, but it's like, the cheapest is like 50 quid nearly, like most places. It's
really?
Like, yeah, it's like at least 45, 50 quid. And it's like, that's quite a lot,
Well, games are 50 quid.
Don't they usually drop
now?
Just before release anyway?
Usually after, they drop a bit, but it's still, it's expensive.
Hmm. Yeah, there were plenty of games I've bought over the years without reading reviews. I mean, I generally don't read reviews, and generally before games are out, everyone knows who played it early, and there's a buzz on Twitter. I can't think of a game I've bought where I like, instantly regret it, because generally by that point I know if I'm going to like it or not. But Mass Effect's definitely one I'm going to buy without review, I think.
How about you, Sean? Is any games that you've regretted?
For some reason, I'm finding myself just thinking about Mass Effect as well. because I don't know. Like, for some reason, I'm weirdly anxious, because I think, like, gameplay wise, it'll be superb because we've seen the trailers and stuff, and the combat looks ace. But like, part of me is sort of thinking, but how am I going to end up giving as much a shit? Much of a shit about the characters as I did in the original trilogy.
But how many games did that take?
And that's like, exactly. So it's an unfair comparison right out of the gate. But
yeah, of course, yeah.
So part of me thinks like, shall I wait? Should I wait for reviews so people be like, look, you're not going to get as attached, but it's still really good, or whatever,
I think I definitely would get like Red Dead Redemption 2. I mean, get that.
Any Rockstar game, you're going to get it because, it'd be amazing.
Yeah, sequels, it's a lot easier to do that with, isn't it?
Yeah.
And although Andromeda's not technically a sequel, it is in that we know we love that universe anyway, so it's a little bit easier to sort of handle.
It's weird that this is the next Mass Effect game is one game in its own right rather than a new trilogy. I just assume they would have done another series of games.
Do you think I like it?
I think they probably, after the migraines they had trying to tie everything together in Mass Effect 3, they're probably like, do you know what? Let's knock this on the head. They've done that with Dragon Age as well. Like, everything's basically come back to a central point. So let's just...
Do you think it's because they don't want to take a risk?
It'd be interesting to see how far they go with it, because, I mean, they did such a good job of tying everything in with Mass Effect 2 that, you know, they can do it. But if they focus fully on just this one story, how crazy that gets. You know what I mean? How different these things
Yeah, because they're not thinking like, well, hang on, how's this going to spiral out in 2 and 3? Like, they can just, it can be self-contained, which actually, yeah, might allow them to do more within one game.
They can fight with the characters where it ends. More, can't they?
Yeah. And especially because this is set in some far-flung corner of the galaxy in 30,000 years' time. It's so completely cut off from everything else.
I really hope it's got the guts to just, you know...
Yeah.
What I'm saying is that, like, I really hope there's an opportunity that everyone dies at the end, but it does it in a way where it doesn't make it feel like you failed. It does it in a way that it makes it feel like that is the ending. Like, that is an acceptable ending to the story. You know what I mean? That's what I'm really interested to see how far they're willing to go with changing the endings and stuff.
Yeah. Do you reckon it's
I was going to say,
do you reckon it's also because they don't want to take like a massive risk with these sorts of things so much now because they're so expensive to develop, like these big like story-based games, whereas you've got other stuff that, you know, like things like Overwatch and everything, which are like raking in the cash for like, and they're not having to like provide that, like, you know, it's sort of such a focused narrative as you get with something like Mass Effect. And it's like, you know, maybe, you know, they feel it's a bit of a risk to go for those now.
Yeah, like, you've got to assume, I mean, maybe this is incredibly wrong, but you would think the budget for something like Overwatch would actually be a hell of a lot less than something that's really heavily sort of narrative-led, like a Mass Effect game or whatever. So, yeah, the return on investment for just a really finely-tuned competitive game must be a lot higher these days than something with a big story, especially if, as we say, they're not planning a series or indeed any DLC, apparently.
And with those like competitive shooters, you can just keep churning out like DLC and things like that and just keep making money off it. Whereas with a game like Mass Effect, you finish it, you trade it in. Whereas other games, you don't do that so much with.
Well, then that's why they introduced the multiplayer stuff. And there was microtransactions with that as well, wasn't there, Sean, if I remember correctly?
Yeah, and it was sort of basically sort of followed the FIFA model in that you were buying packs of cards which then unlocked things. So like they would unveil like, oh, here's a new free expansion, there's a new map and like new characters, and you would get the map and that was cool, but in order to get new characters and weapons and stuff, you just had to unlock them by chance by buying these packs. So a new, you know, quote unquote free DLC bit would come out and you'd be like, I'm gonna spend 15 quid on packs to see if I can get any of the new stuff, which was kind of shitty, but you could unlock tons of stuff without paying, though, so I think it was all right.
Oh, God, and I just remember all the stuff they stuck in Mass Effect 3. Like the DLC character that was there from the start that had a huge spoiler in his, like, description. Do you remember?
Oh, which one was that?
Jarvik?
Oh, the, yeah.
Yeah, basically, we could probably talk about it now. There was a character that you downloaded at the start, like you paid extra for, you downloaded at the start of Mass Effect 3, that was a of an alien race that had been extinct for for hundreds of years. And it was kind of like, because, and if it, oh, this is a, what was it? What was the race called?
I'm trying to remember what they were called now.
Protheans. Yeah, you'd heard about them, the Protheans, for like all the way through. I don't know if they were in Mass Effect 1 because I didn't play it all the way to
They're definitely mentioned, yeah.
Mentioned all the way through Mass Effect 2. And then, like, you go to launch Mass Effect 3. Do you want to download this Prothean character? And they're all dead. Oh, no. Wait a minute.
Yeah, it was weird because they didn't even try and keep it a secret, did they? It was like fully marketed. Like, you can have a Prothean in your team.
Yeah.
Whereas, like, the way, like, when you actually play it, the way he's unlocked, like, if that had been a surprise, it would have been the fucking best thing. I mean, the cool twist that it is that he was kind of a dick. And it was like, you know, you've spent two games being like, oh, my God, the Protheans are this super wise high-tech race that came before us, but they got wiped out, and it's like, no, you meet one and he's just a bit of a wanker.
Well, the joke was that he was just really arrogant with it and he couldn't believe how stupid humans were. Like, they thought they'd worked everything out, but it was kind of like, no, you idiots. Yeah, fuck, I love that. You know,
James, I've just looked and you can get Mass Effect Andromeda for £40 on the gamecollection.net.
All right, okay. So
that's a nice save.
Because I look on Amazon, it's like £49 or something.
No, it's 46 or 44 if you've got a Prime.
Yeah, I know, still expensive, but yeah, £40's not so bad. Did you see? Have you seen how much like Breath of the Wild is on Wii U as a download code from Amazon? It's no, £60 if you want to.
But would it be £60 on the eShop though?
Don't know.
It surely it'd be the same price, right?
I don't know. I can't. I mean, £60. It's
whoa. Let's move on to the next question. This is come on.
All right. Anyway, so we've got some tweets. If you want to tweet us, it's at Computer Game Pod. So the first one is Robot of Doom. He says, what's the longest it's taken for you to finish a game without restarting it? Took me over 6 years to finally do Heavy Rain.
Well, it's just taken me 4 years to do Fire Emblem Awakening.
That's a good shout. I should say Half-Life 2, but I did restart it a couple of times, so doesn't count. But I remember from the first time I played it to the time that I finished it, it was, you know... I played it launch week, and I finished it 2 years ago. But probably, I guess, Dark Souls? That took me nearly a year.
Mm-hmm. I've been playing Oracle of Ages, you know, the Zelda game, for on and off for about 4 years now. I just can't bring myself to play it for some reason. Just play a bit at a time.
Matt?
I can't think of an example.
Great. Excellent. Next question.
Okay, Hazer of Mist says, can you please ask Sean why he hates the fans so much? What did we ever do to him? Do we represent the jocks from school?
Do I hate the fans? Is that how I come across?
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, okay. I wasn't intentional. It's just, I don't know, subconscious unpleasantness that I can't keep a lid on, apparently. No, I don't hate the
fans.
He
loves the fans.
Maybe. That was the most insincere. I've
never heard. Because I'm now questioning myself. Because if that's how I've come across, then maybe there's something I need to recognise within myself.
You hate the fans.
Also, let's just call them listeners, not fans.
Hang on, Dave's the one who's like, no, I don't want to do community nights. No, I'm not doing a meet-up.
It's definitely more Dave than Sean.
It doesn't mean that I don't.
Like, the fact that I'm sitting here thinking, thank God Dave said it and not me, means nothing, right?
No, it's, I mean, I don't dislike it. I just don't want to know you. That's the way I look at it. That's all right, isn't it?
Anyway, Don Johnson says, after an impressive display from Team CGS on Rocket League, are you guys willing to play against any of the community?
So absolutely not, no. Next question.
Sinui says, are you worried about your kids getting scammed by shady YouTuber douchebags like, what are these names? This is like Nepenthes and...
I'm assuming they're the...
This is the FIFA scammers.
Yeah.
FIFA scammers.
Yeah.
That is... I hope that I'm not, you know, underselling how I feel about this. That is fucking deplorable, horrible, nasty people... fuck them. Did they get away with a fine or did they get put away?
Syndicate, I can't remember.
I think it was a fine.
Nepenthes, he got done for like £30,000 or £50,000 fine last week.
That's not enough. Not enough.
I mean, his company made over $1 million. I think 1.4 million.
It's fucking ridiculous.
Apparently his excuse was, it's not like I set out to try and break the law. As if the fact that, like, even if what he was doing wasn't illegal, it's clearly... fucking shit.
Horribly immoral. For those of you that don't know, these were two guys that were running a website where you could physically gamble.
Syndicate, I think, was a separate thing. I think that could be CSGO skins, whereas FIFA foot.
But the idea was the same thing, right? You were taking content from a game that has monetary value and you were getting people to pile that stuff into their system in a hope that they would come away with more of that. That item, yeah. Right? Is that how it works?
You can use like the in-game currency to bet on football matches, I believe, and for CSGO, you bet in-game currency to potentially win skins. And these two guys were like directors.
They would make YouTube videos of them playing on their own site and winning to try and convince children to do the same thing And obviously, you know, they wouldn't win and end up piling money of, like, piling stuff that's worth money into their website. It's a fucking nasty, horrible tactic. It's a fucking disgraceful way to try and take money out of people. And I don't understand how they haven't had time, like, how they haven't been put inside for it for just, you know, even if it's just 6 months, but just to, like, fucking drum the point home that you should not be taking advantage of people like this. Yeah, I worry about if my kids can do that? Absolutely. Absolutely. Because it's easy to turn around and say, well, I'm quite aware of this stuff. So, you know, I understand the risks of the internet. I understand kids don't give a shit. And if they really want to do something, they'll do something outside your, you know, site where you can control them. They'll do it around their friend's house or whatever. Yeah. Your child being taken advantage of like that, of course it freaks me out. I just hope cases like this have exposed it a little bit more, and that maybe, I know none of us want the internet regulated. I know laws on the internet are a questionable thing, but in some areas there fucking needs to be stronger laws on the internet. It's as simple as that. Of course they do. And it's weird, as if this has somehow avoided law because it was on a subject that old people don't understand. Do you know what I mean? It's like, yeah. How have they got away with this? Fucking gambling. Sorry, it made me angry.
No, I totally agree.
But in the end, they were done under gambling or laws, weren't they? So yeah, the law got them in the end.
Yeah, but how did they get away with that for so long? If this was betting on football on the internet, this would have been taken down a lot quicker.
True.
Do you know what I mean? If there was a guy on YouTube betting on his own site and winning and trying to appeal to children, they would have got away with it. They wouldn't have got away with it for that long. Yeah, fucking nasty. That's all I've got to say about that.
I mean, sorry. For me, if I call my daughter on this, it would be like when your parents caught you with a fag, you know, they'll make you smoke the whole box. I'll say, here's all your pocket money. We're betting the whole lot on FIFA. Oh, wait, we've won. Shit, this is amazing. keep it going.
This is the problem. Harry had a balloon. Talking of gambling, Harry had a balloon
great
the
story.
Other day.
Next question.
I was looking after him, and he was like laying down on the balloon, and then he started rubbing his teeth along the balloon constantly, and I'm going Harry, don't do that. It's going to pop, you're going to smack your face on the floor, right? It's going to hurt and it's going to scare you. Please stop doing that. And he looked at me, smiled, and carried on doing it. And I prayed that fucking balloon would pop and it just hurt himself just a little bit, just to teach him a lesson that maybe when I say don't do something, you probably shouldn't do it. Instead, he had a whale of a time on that balloon. It was like it was made of steel. He was having a great time on it, and it didn't pop, and I just looked like I was a dickhead.
Dave, you sent me that video of him squeaking his face in a balloon. I can't believe he lasted more than 1 second. I would have popped it in front of him. So I can't. I'm going to kill someone if I hear that balloon. Oh, that sound was so bad.
It was horrific, and I was praying that balloon would pop. But instead, it didn't, and he had a great time.
My balloon story is that Elodie had a balloon in the back of the car, and she kept, like, you know, basically almost popping it and like throwing it around the car. Look, like, this isn't happening anymore. And Jill had it like near the passenger window, and she said, look, if you keep mucking about, we're gonna let it go out the window. We're gonna let it go. And then we go back to Eddie, she kicked off like, that's it, we're gonna let go. And Jill actually let go of her balloon out of the window, and we still to this day drive in the car, and Eddie's like, red balloon, Mum. I think I saw the red balloon. It's like, you're not going to see the red balloon's gone. We instantly regretted it, because Elodie couldn't believe her eyes, the fact that her mum let her red balloon go to, like...
You have to follow through.
Yeah,
you have to follow through all these.
She still mentions
the
red balloon. Like, as if we, like, no, that wasn't your red balloon, Elodie. It's gone. Yeah, we felt
Rachel,
so bad.
Rachel never forgets the, like, her chocolate that I ate once as, like, as part of that. Yeah.
Do we're taking parenting advice from someone that lies about when their child's birthday is over here. You know what I mean?
When did I ever do that?
You did love for years.
You did that a couple of years ago.
No, it's not lying about when it is. It's just not making her realise when
it is. A different day.
Yeah, no, it's... No.
You said it was
because
a different
day.
Because
it makes life more convenient.
Yeah, because there was reasons for that. It's because my wife was in China at the time, and we didn't want her to feel that her mum wasn't there at her birthday, so we were just like, it's okay, it's on this day. And then when mummy's back...
Have you noticed the James Farley technique? Lie, 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 oh shit, I've been caught out and proved wrong. I'll tell the story, but try and justify it.
It's total justification for that. It's the only reason I did that, was for that.
But you started off your argument saying we didn't lie, we just didn't tell them where it is. Well, yeah, and then you said, well, we did lie, but there were reasons.
No, it would have been a lie if she'd have said to us, is it my birthday today? And I'd have said, no. But we didn't
so
do
instead
that.
Instead, she woke up on her birthday and you just stayed silent.
But then today.
The lie comes in a few days later when you go, happy birthday, it's your birthday today.
I mean,
it's great because, like, I see what you're saying, James. It is justifiable in context because at the end of the day, kids
don't
know.
When they're 2 years old, they don't know.
But, go on. But it's just funny that you're. There's still obviously an element of guilt there
that you're seeing her in the morning and going, hello, Rachel. Normal day, isn't it?
I remember when that happened because I remember sending you a message about that, and I was like, "It's Rachel's birthday today." She's got no idea.
Yeah, I love that.
Have you got any balloon stories? Tweet us at the computer.
James, look, if she asked me if it's a birthday, I would have said, "She goes, Daddy, what day is it today?" It's Tuesday.
Yeah, she's fine. She still had an amazing birthday just a couple of days later.
Does she know
what really
her birthday is now?
Yes.
Tuesday. It's on a Tuesday, Daddy.
My birthday's once every 2 years. Okay. Let's do one more and then wrap it up.
Okay. You mean what? Completely? Because there's a whole ton of tweets. We've only done like 3 tweets. There's loads of them.
Come on. Let's knock them out.
We're 2 hours in, Matt.
That's nothing. It's not going to come on, James.
All right, Phil Wall says, Miyamoto said that Link's full name is Link Link. Which other characters are so good they should be named twice?
Is that, that's got to be
it
a joke,
is, he's just
it?
On a wind-up, isn't he?
Someone said on Twitter, which I didn't read the article about it, I saw the link to the Link Link story. And they turned around and said, do you not understand that he was clearly being asked shit questions all day and that was his way of just throwing you off? I just go, Link, Link, whatever, just next.
Yeah, it's great.
Obviously, it's going through a translator, but he's doing the equivalent of, his name's fucking Link Link, you twat. Fucking, I don't know.
Just leave me alone. I enjoyed playing Mario, making the first Mario. Next question. No, that wasn't the question they were asking, though. So what character would you like to hear named twice? Think of a really long character name. It's probably a Dark Souls one, right?
I can't think of any. I can't think of any that, you know, get any comedic value out of just having the same name twice.
Donkey Donkey? You say Donkey Kong?
No, because it would be Donkey Kong Donkey Kong.
Well, no, because...
That's pretty
good.
Yeah,
okay. That works. I assume Donkey's his first name and Kong was a surname.
Donkey Donkey. I think you're right, that's actually. So, yeah, it'd be Donkey Donkey.
Donkey Donkey is a good answer, then.
So I'm getting the feeling of what Miyamoto feels like now. Yeah. Can we move on?
let's do it.
Alex79UK says, question for the show. Straight Dave, you get involved in some drunk fumbling with one of the other podcasters. Which one?
Wooden Atman.
That's not a question.
If I had to choose, it would be Matt because he's clearly the cleanest.
How little, you know.
No, you've got good hygiene,
yeah, I
think.
Yeah. I wash my bits at least once a month.
Look, just because I don't iron my shirts, right, I'm still clean. I feel like I'm protesting too much. Dave, fuck me. Come on.
Yeah, but you got that beard and that, and you're always going on walks.
I just... Yeah. I resent the implication. This is horrible.
James, come on. You're nowhere near.
What?
You've always wearing... sweatshirts for a start.
Oh god, imagine.
Well, just the underarm. I'm not calling you dirty, but By 5:30, I reckon should probably, you know, sort yourself out.
It's pretty much one of the worst things you've ever said to me, David. Good. Simon Saint says, which game has the best shooting, Destiny or Doom?
That was Doom, obviously.
Is really? It?
Yeah.
I haven't played enough Doom, yeah. But Destiny feels so good shooting-wise.
No. Doom's got much better like, action.
If you could take Doom, like a game as good as Doom, and put the Destiny shit around it, that's surely one of the best games ever made. And I'm sure people listen to this and go, no, I'd fucking ruin Doom if you did that.
Yeah, but that's not what you're saying, is it? You're just saying with that on top of it would make a good game. And I think you're right. Yeah. But still, the Destiny shooting was fantastic. Like popping heads in Destiny. You didn't get that satisfaction in Doom. Doom was kind of like spray bullets and they die. And that was brilliant. I'm not putting that down. Trust me, I am not putting that down. But popping heads in Destiny was fucking really good fun.
I hope Andy listens to this.
If we were voting, I hope he don't. I don't need him as a listener. If we were voting, you two would vote Doom.
Yeah, I would.
And you'd vote Destiny,
I haven't played enough Doom yet to comment, but Destiny just feels so good.
Yeah, that's fair. Probably Destiny for me.
Okay.
Did we talk about next one? Destiny 2 has been, you know, confirmed for this year and... There's like an exclusivity with Sony for 3 months, so that's almost certainly going to open up, you know, the Sony's E3 conference.
I can't wait to play that.
I'm so excited to see what they do.
Same.
I reckon they're really going to nail it this time. Now, I know we've said that a lot about Destiny, but I think they're really going to nail it. I can't wait for Destiny 2.
Yeah. It's going to be big.
Okay, next one's from Athene Allen. She says, I played the Switch this weekend. Why are you all so wrong on it? I should be wrong about it.
What?
Turner's is proper down on it. Matt cancelled his pre-orders. Sean is filled with trepidation. No idea what Farley thinks. I tune out whenever he talks.
Does Athene listen to this show? How have I been down on it?
And how am I filled with trepidation? I'm fucking well up for it.
And how has Matt cancelled any of his pre-orders?
And I'm psyched as fuck. If anything, I wish I was less hyped because I'm going to be disappointed. But yeah, I can't wait.
What'd she say about James?
I don't know. Care.
I tend to tune out whenever I read her tweets. So yeah.
I'm not...
And I hate the fans.
I think I've been quite fair on it, haven't I? Like I think as hardware, I think it's going to be really exciting. I've got no reason to buy one at this point. I was disappointed with the announcement because there wasn't a huge amount of games out day one. As we said while we were playing Rocket League, PSVR had a stronger launch lineup than the Switch did, which is insane. But I really like it and I'm going to get one at the end of the year. It's just it's not right for me to get one now. As I said, the main reason was because we were talking, because I'm getting well excited, like seeing everyone get pumped for it and talking about pre-orders and all this sort of stuff, right? I was totally getting swept away and I was thinking, man, I really want to switch now. Like, I really do. But and in our sort of group chat, there was people going, well, just sell your Wii U and put the money towards it and stuff. And I'm saying, yeah, but I can't not have a Mario game in this house. That's not going to go down well.
Yeah, I was thinking this as well, the same thing. It's like, I've got a lot of games for you, actually, that I play with the kids, and if I was just to get rid of them, they'd be pretty upset. Yeah.
If Odyssey was there day one, then yes, I would be getting a Switch, but it's not, so I'll get that when it comes out. That's the way I'm looking at it. Is that it? Are we done now?
That's it, yeah.
Cool. Matt, how can they contact the show? What do you want them to do on social media this week?
You can tweet us. We're at Computer Game Pod on Twitter. We love getting your feedback and your comments throughout the week, so hit us up on Twitter.
Oh, I don't, apparently.
Sean doesn't. Neither does Dave. Neither does Fi.
I'll just tell you, go fuck yourself.
I love engagement.
No, I love it when people tweet in. I just don't want to play games with you.
Tweet all you want. Just don't add us on PSN. So we're at Computer Game Pod on Twitter. We're also on Facebook, Twitch, all the rest. New episodes go up on our YouTube channel. Just search for The Computer Game Show or go to youtube.com/The Computer Game Show. This week, we put up a video of us four playing Rocket League and it's a pretty decent video. I liked it. So have a watch of that. You can also email the show at thecomputergameshow@gmail.com.
Cool. And we'll see you next week. Thanks for living it. Goodbye.
Bye.
Yeah, cheers.
Bye-bye. Yeah, bye-bye.